Okay.
John.
We'll call this Arundel Planning Board to order, it's a regular meeting, November 12th, 2015, at 7:01 PM. Start with a roll call.
James Lowry.
Bob Coombe.
Rich Ganong.
Roger Moran.
John Dergendron.
Tom Dergen.
Ted Redway, planner. Okay. Today, we have the approval of the agenda. Under that agenda, we have the approval of minutes of November 5th, 2015. We have a public hearing for the RSU 21 MLD school expansion. We have pending applications. We have two pending applications. One is the RSU 21 MLD school expansion plenary site plan. Item number two is Brookside Estates, a preliminary subdivision application. We then go to new applications. Item one under the new applications is Motorland conditional use application. Item number two is ServPro plenary site plan application. We then have land use ordinance revisions, a review of the new land use format. We'll then hear from the planner on his report, and then we'll all go home. Need a motion to approve the agenda.
I make a motion to approve the agenda as written and read.
Second. Motion's been made and seconded. Is there anything that the board wants to add to the agenda? Hearing nothing, all those in favor? Anyone opposed? Motion is unanimous. Let the record show that Marty has joined us at 7:03.
Clock.
7:03 PM. Marty, I was off by 2 minutes. I said 7:05.
I've got 7:05.
Oh, okay. Okay, first item of business for today will be the public hearing from...
Minutes.
Probably approval of the minutes. I'm sorry, you're right. November 5th, 2015. You should have copies in your packet. I have an extra copy if somebody needs one. The minutes from last...
I never got any of my packet.
Yes, no, it wasn't. It was emailed. That's right.
No, I'm not gonna add it. Mine was delivered to my house.
Mine was good.
Yeah.
Sure, what's on there?
Yeah, look.
I think I got this right.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes as written.
Motion has been made to approve the minutes of November 5th as written.
I'll second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? See anything, Marty?
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
Motion's been made and seconded to approve the minutes as written. All those in favor? Any abstentions? Two abstentions.
Two abstentions. So the abstentions.
John and I were. Now we can move on. MLD school expansion. This is the public hearing. It's 7:06. If I look at that clock, if I look at mine, it's
7:07.
You want to do the presentation?
Well, let's see if there's anybody.
Is there anybody here from the public for this presentation?
Or interested in what's going on?
Okay.
Okay. Basically, what we have is the existing school building here is going to be demolished from basically the corridor we come in down to the end of the classroom wing. We're going to be putting up a new building, taking down about 24,000 square feet, putting up about 24,000 square feet. There's going to be a new gym, new cafeteria, new classroom space, replace what's coming in, new library. So the new building is going to go along the front of the property where the current parking lot is now. And the parking and the new bus loop is going to be where the current building is, where we're standing at. We're also having a new service yard, new utilities for the, and we're going to expand some of the parking. Also have a new stormwater drain system to take care of the stormwater through new DEP rules. We're going to maintain existing exits and entrances, so they're not going to change. We have some new landscaping in the parking lot, screening for the service area. And a comment made at the last meeting was we had some, a couple more trees along Limerick Road in front of the building. So just basically the quick rundown of the project. Any questions?
No.
Okay. Anything else from the public?
Yes, sir. Just curious what you're doing to address the building settlement issues in the future?
Sir, could I have your name, sir?
Kevin Riley.
Okay, thank you.
All right, well, yes, the, one of the reasons why this building is coming down is because it's settling a little bit.
Yeah.
We've done extensive geotech studies. We've done three studies, including slope stability analysis, several sets of borings, and also the settlement analysis of the existing building. So the area we chose, geologically, we have glacial till overlaying bedrock. So we have a very stiff foundation to put the building on. It's, the soils are good versus what happens here as we go towards the turnpike, it goes into some stiff clay, and then over here, this is a very soft clay. So this part of the existing building is pretty much stayed where it's been built. It's just the corners out towards the turnpike and towards the brook that have settled the most. So anyway, yeah, part of the existing building is out here, that's where it's the soft clay. So that's why we're putting the building over here and the parking over that. And we're also lowering the grade in the area of the current building to reduce and stop that sinking. So basically, it's with the fill that was brought in to build the building that helps make it sink. So we're going to take some soil off to unburden that soft clay, and then to, you know, to stop the subsistence of the soil around the parking lot and in that area. Yeah, that was carefully studied, as you might consider. Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
Any other comments by the public? Hearing none, we will close the public hearing at 7:10. Pending applications. RSU 21, you are first on the list. We should all have
on board status updates since the last one.
Do you have comments?
No, you had mentioned something about a variance at the ZBA.
I had mentioned to you, yes.
Yeah.
We have the outstanding issue of the lot coverage. The RSU attorney and the town's attorney and the town manager are working to submit an application to the ZBA for the lot coverage issue. Also, the other issue is the town of Rundle lot was created without any frontage on Limerick Road. So that's also being considered as being a bit of a redivision of the lots to give frontage to the back lot using the estate lot provisions in your ordinance, and then try to get a variance for the lot coverage.
Do you have any idea when you go to the ZBA with that?
I believe the plan to try to get into the ZBA in December.
Okay.
Question, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mark.
And through the planner also. this is, the entrance is more or less quote unquote a private way. It doesn't have any name, the entrance. If it turned, if to the back lot, if it, it would access it through a private way or road name, would that turn around and also give it frontage or accessibility on the paper term?
Well,
I don't know if anybody's thought of that one.
We turn this upside down, inside out, and look at it from all angles. What will, what the proposal is right now is because there is this strip of land, basically, between, that is owned by the Turnpike Authority, and because of setbacks, this would not be the route in which we would have a private way, or the access strip for an estate lot would not be through the current entrance, simply because that would cause a number of problems when we divide the land. It would create a serious setback, because now we would have to have a setback from the private, from this. That probably could occur. Mm-hmm. But basically what it would do is it would take all of this and turn it into a road, and we would have to do a private way, and we'd have to build it up to road standards. That's number one. Plus, cutting it across with a private way through the main turnpike land would actually cut this lot into two pieces, giving us a sliver of land here that would be a non-conforming lot. Would meet minimum lot size, lot frontage, setbacks, all the rest of that. Just wouldn't, it would be an illegal lot.
Question for you on
can't
that
go
basis.
That route.
On that basis, we had the same thing at VIP, okay? Because where their property line is and everything else, the fact is that the state or DOT granted them access to it, because we're actually, the property line is on VIP. This VIP is like 50, 60 feet inward. Mm-hmm. So that's why I was asking that particular thought or question.
Well, the thing about the VIP versus this, we basically, the action of cutting this created an illegal back lot. And the only way we could do that, we can't use an easement, we would have to, and this, we would have to essentially use the access strip, which is a fee conveyance. It's actually part of the lot, which would create all sorts of havoc over here. So it looks like probably it will be flipped over to the other side. We'd have to basically go in the stream corridor there.
So that would be the strip of land 50 feet wide to the Limerick Road, giving you frontage for the estate lot, and the access would be through the easement.
Right.
The vehicle access.
Right. So this meets the legal requirements, and this would basically be the easement in which we would have actual access.
I'm just hearing this for the first time.
Yeah.
If you're looking to get a variance, I'm assuming that you're getting a variance because of the coverage and impervious area on the front lot.
Yeah.
If you move forward like you just suggested that you're moving forward, would we not then create a school and property that can never expand in the future? Are we kicking a problem down the road?
I don't think the school's going to expand out the back for the very reason why the school's being pushed to the front, because the soils are unsuitable for any more construction in the back. Address that, John.
Just wanted to make sure everybody's looking at that, because once that's how you go, I mean, we're exceeding in front already. I mean, that would almost eliminate.
Well, this front wall is pretty much maximized now.
Yeah.
So there's really no.
Eliminate any further.
Even without the issue of the coverage, there's not a lot of room to expand to create additional building for classroom space. We're pretty much maxed out. We can't go this way because the soils won't allow it. We originally had a classroom wing here early in the concept, found out, no, that's gonna fall off and be a problem, so that's not, that went away. So this is the only place we can build, and we pretty much maximized out building envelope that block. We don't wanna come out this way, because again, we get into the soils that are unsuitable. So there's really, the constraints of the lot doesn't allow it to really expand.
Where are your ball fields?
Ball fields are still back here.
Okay, I mean, I'm just showing, showing for the full survey, or thinking of the survey in itself, because we have ever had to expand back onto the ball field. I'm just thinking along that question of if ever they needed expansion.
So the ball field is the other side of the stream, so it would be, wouldn't be connected to.
Is there a reason why the ball fields are separated from the other school parcel? It doesn't make sense.
Well, the fields are basically the town's. The school doesn't use these fields. They have the playground here. It is mostly smaller kids.
The school doesn't use the fields?
They don't use these fields.
They don't play ball on?
Well, some of the kids that go to the school do, but it's in.
But that's for town, sports events. That's town rental sponsored events versus RSU 21.
School. It's all the rec departments.
Yeah, exactly. So there's, you know, there's different purposes.
I have a question about the ZBA. If you're going to the ZBA, I thought normally it would be, we'd deny an application and then they have to go for the appeal. Is it the Board of Appeals?
This has come up in between. This is a hence after fact of pulling it out.
Well then I'm wondering, what will the Board of Appeals be basing their decision on?
On what the variance is, which is the five criteria established by the state.
Okay, and they can do that before the planning board acts.
Yeah, well, essentially, yes. I mean, the condition exists right now where the division occurred in August, and the land's been conveyed. So the land has been conveyed to the RSU, and the town is retaining the other portion, the residual portion. The town has a problem because we have a landlocked parcel of land, which we can't do under our own ordinances, so we have a problem that has to be resolved. And because the existing condition is when that division occurred, basically, this lot also became non-conforming because the lot coverage with existing conditions without any of the proposed improvements was at 30% in a zone in which 20% lot coverage is required. With the improvements, we're gonna get up close to 40%.
I hate to be cynical, but it seems to me like it's a case of just act and then ask for forgiveness rather than ask for permission ahead.
We're going through the procedure, but you know, we're gonna go to the ZBA and see what happens with that. And then once we get the results of that, we'll proceed with the next step.
Tonight I'm the big call.
Yeah. I mean, ideally,
so,
I think it would
it's just
been
so obvious and blatant. It's so basic. Just the access back there. Who's the lawyer involved in all this?
It goes back, there's a history that goes beyond August. Because when the RSU and the town, when the RSU was formed and the town of Rundle became part of it, there's agreements to do this division. And that was all set in place, but no one actually executed those divisions. So when they finally go to build the school improvement, they say, whoops, so then they pass that. There's a bit of a history to that, yeah.
Well, it's a school and it belongs to all of us, and most people in town want the better school, but if this was anybody else but the town of Arundel in the school district that were asking for this type of mistake to get washed, it would look bad, you know.
We would have rejected it. We would have had to go to the zoning board of appeals.
Well, right now, quite frankly, this board cannot approve this application.
Yeah, we can't.
Right.
We would have to reject this. This board has no choice but to reject it. So that's why we're having a public hearing, right, and then going to see how the RSU is going to get, and the town is going to resolve this. So he puts it in a position where the planning board can approve this because it does meet our space and bulk requirements and all the other requirements. requirements of our conditional use and site plan.
So one way or another, we will get something that you can approve by the time come, meet the next time. So I mean, with either the CBA or they come up with another solution.
Yeah, and the other, if I could, the other solution is they need to deed us all the property so that it is conformed. I mean, it's a catch 22.
Yeah, or at least that portion to give you enough.
Yes.
Right.
Well, yeah, the whole property is 25 acres. To make this conforming, we need 19.5 approximately, 19.7. So at least 5 acres, so.
And that would still make it.
Include the fields.
Yeah.
So the fields would not be included in that, so it's kind of a waste to do it that way, because.
I agree.
The athletic fields of the recreation department and the volunteers are put together would actually be on the school property. The objective here is to keep it all in one unit. As a town facility.
Let me understand the way you're thinking about access to the ball fields. Mm-hmm. You're proposing to put a right of way up in the northern.
Not quite a right of way. More of it is a extension of the width of land. So there's a connection.
So an actual transferred fee?
Transferred fee of land, okay. Connection between this lot and the street.
It's right. A flag lot.
It's flag lot, or a state lot.
What we call the state lot.
The vehicular access would still remain through this easement, and that will not change.
But that will there be some kind of an easement or?
Well, then some of this wetland here would become part of this lot. And
no, in terms of access over.
This easement still exists. So,
and that easement would remain in place and give the town access to the fields.
Yeah, so nothing would change in that regard. So this is all just sort of paper shuffling.
Well, paper shuffling, yes, but if you're proposing to give us access in the northerly area,
yeah.
And it's kind of swampy, so it's sort of, not really.
Well, don't think of it as access, just think of it as frontage.
It's gaining, right. Gaining right. The road frontage.
All you do is gaining road
establish
frontage
a legitimate
as a state lot, and then the access still stays the same. The access is this access easement, and that's always going to be access. So this is just a matter of a vehicle providing frontage, and that's all it's doing.
Okay. I know the difficulty you're struggling with here.
Yeah, it is really, it's sort of a,
it is
playing a high game real fast.
Yes.
I don't like it.
Two cars.
Under an easement, does an easement have to be utilized?
Well,
I mean, you can throw it on this way. You can throw it on paper.
Does a frontage always have to be utilized? That's the question you really want to ask. Not the easement, but does an access strip that is supposed to be the access to an estate lot or a flag lot. Is there anything in the ordinance that requires that access strip to actually be the sole access to the lot? And the answer is
no.
Thank you.
There's nothing that requires that access.
So do you have
that?
Yeah.
Right. So basically, we're going to give you a dollar, and you're going to give us a piece of land that says here. You now have a complete lot that fronts Limerick Road.
Right, and you're still going to have the same access, and nothing's going to really change. It's just a paper change. It's going to be a paper access to the street that makes it conform.
I have to make sure that easement can never be vacated.
Exactly.
I'll tell you.
Right here. I don't like
from this confluence down, we've got a shoreline, we've got a stream protection district, and from here on down, we've got a resource protection.
Well, John, ultimately, that's the same thing that was proposed 2 weeks ago. Access has always been up through the turnpike side of the parcel.
Yeah, that's acceptable.
Nothing really is changing there other than some semantics on where the property sits to get the legal front.
Exactly, that's all it is.
Yeah. And if we...
I don't have a problem with that as long as there's some kind of a legal document that says we... Forever and a day, we have the rights to come in through that entrance as well.
Yeah, and that's going to be part of the deeds and the easements. I believe the attorney's going to create that. That's the current deed always gives you that full free access, and also rights to use the parking lot for the any events that are in the fields, the town has the right to use the school's parking lot for those sports events. So, and then the RSU's septic system is here beside the fields, and that he gives the RSU free access to maintain upgraded septic system. So it is.
It's all there. It's a very symbiotic relationship.
Very symbiotic relationship.
The town and the RSU were joined.
Yeah.
Yeah, needs to, yeah.
It's all in the public interest for both.
How is your review going through the DEP?
So far, so good. I'm still waiting for stormwater comments, but everything else seems to be satisfactory with them. A couple minor comments and some things that I had to address. Again, like the Ted's and the board's comments on the landscaping, I'll address them when I get the town's stormwater comments, as well as town engineers doing reviewing the stormwater as well.
There was some discussion about the light at the entrance, and some of us believed you said you were going to put in a light.
Well, we're going to try to ask CMP to put a pole here and put one of those pole on these. Right now, there's across the street, there's a light with a big cobra head, but it doesn't work. but there's a light there.
Just going back to the discussion and what we should expect in the plan. You had mentioned the landscaping, putting in some additional trees.
Some three more trees.
That was part of that discussion. Yeah. Marty had brought up the front, so I'm assuming that would be on your new plan.
That will be on my new plan.
The other thing is, too, we mentioned it may be more cost effective to turn on and put, not a CMP, but to turn and put your own there.
Mm-hmm.
Because we will allow carrying on the power and light to service it.
Mm-hmm.
And it will be more cost effective than bending and smiling at CMP.
Right. We'll look at that.
But the way you just phrased it, that sounded like it was going strictly to ZMP.
No,
they're the applicant.
Yeah. We have to go through the RSU and there's other people that are involved in that negotiation, so I can't say yes or no right now.
Does the board have any more questions for the applicant?
Waiting time to see.
That's basically.
I just have one minor question. Up in the gray area to the north, you have those dark lines.
These are just utility crossings. This is for the water
pipe. Okay, I was trying to.
These are just passes for the new asphalt that's going to be utility crossings.
You are leaving the big pines out there, aren't they? These
are staying, yeah. We're not touching that.
No.
Just checking.
There's no plans.
We used to use Christmas tree lightings.
No, there's absolutely no plans to change those trees.
Back in the 80s.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
And we'll still believe in that.
That
was useful.
I heard that.
I remember we were in public forum.
Okay. Item number two, Brookside Estates. Preliminary subdivision application, conditional use application. So we have a letter from the fire chief that says everything is okay.
Right.
We were able to get it out of you today.
I'm saying it's surprising. We got actually a letter.
Yeah, we don't, you know, fix the emails anymore. Emails.
We have the peer review on the subdivision. No, I was just commenting that we had it. You're up, boss.
Good evening. Andy Morrill, PH2M. I'm just going to go through briefly some changes that the plans have undergone since you guys saw them. You can see them in our cover letter, dated October 28th. added a lot coverage detail, updated the building setbacks on the exterior portions of the property, as we talked about at the last planning board meeting. We added some 25-foot landscape buffers. Also, as we talked about, as the chairman just mentioned, we have the letter from C.B. Mahar addressing a lot of the well and septic issues. The roadway ditches have been eliminated as part of the project, and the stormwater has been updated accordingly. We added the path to Goth Brook, and the street trees were also added to Sheet 4. So that's a summary of the major changes that have happened in the plan. There are some other minor changes that have been made, you can see in our letter. We did receive comments today from Woodard and Curran and from planning staff. Reviewing those, it looks like there are three items. The applicant will be looking for some direction from the board this evening. That would be a discussion about paved gravel or grass shoulders on the edge of the road. The well zones on lots 2, 3, and 4, and the landscaping requirements within the buffer areas. So the applicant would be hopeful to get some direction from the board tonight. Our hope would be to get some revised plans to you next week, and hopefully have a public hearing at the next meeting.
Okay, so the revisions you just spoke about, I don't have them. You haven't submitted them yet?
Yep, they were submitted after the 28th.
In your packet?
They're also highlighted with the letter, the town planner's letter.
Right there, November 11th?
No, that's, hold on.
Now, Brookside Street.
October 28th was the...
October 28th?
Yep.
It should say it on the sheet inside, that looks like it. It says revisions. Oh, yeah, the old one.
Ted, what you did give us was...
Yeah, I thought it was in the...
You gave us...
That's all right, I'll catch up.
That identified each of the areas of the...
I have a copy of the letter, if you'd like to read it.
No, the letter, I'm not, I was concerned about the new plans, but I'll catch up with Ted and get those.
Okay.
So, we were discussing the letter.
Is this the letter we're speaking of, Ted?
Yes.
The letter we're talking about was peer review.
You've got three items you have. An item that was submitted by BH2M, it is
September 30th?
October 28th.
I have September 30th. I don't have anything on October 28th.
The woodland improvement review.
Yeah, which folder? We didn't have any folder.
Jeez.
But you highlighted in your minute, we had the discussion and you put down all of the action items, didn't you?
I handed a lot to you guys at the last meeting.
Last meeting was last week.
Yeah.
This is your phone call?
Yes, that's it.
That's all right, yeah. So you guys were...
That's our plan, John.
Yeah, it's got the plans in it.
Yeah.
Okay, I thought I gave you yours yesterday, 3 days ago. Okay, let me just take mine.
Well, let's get back to the...
Keep going, John.
Peer review from Woodard and Curran.
Yep.
There are a couple of lots that I think need some scrutiny. From reading their letter, it doesn't seem like they're offering an opinion. This is talking lots 2, 3, and 4, I believe. Although to me, lot 10 was 9 and 10.
They commented on 9 and 10.
However, the peer review didn't seem to flag those as problems. They look like problems on the map.
They haven't finished their study on that.
They haven't finished?
No.
Okay, so you can't really make any determinations.
Well, they couldn't either because the plan that they had didn't have the proposed basin. They referred to one, but it wasn't on the plan, so Woodland kind of assumed that if those were put in, we'd probably look at them. They took their letters actually. But they couldn't come to conclusion because it's not part of their plan, so.
Okay, maybe I need a little explanation. Let's look at lots 3 and 4. The reason that the well zones are where they are is because of replacement of the septic system, as I understand this. So that gives us very small zones for the wells. Now, even if those zones prove to be correct with water determinants finalized study, like look at lot number 3, you've got, what is that, 10 by 10 foot area where you can put a well? What if it doesn't work out?
Go deep.
Yep.
There was a big write-up and I didn't quite understand all of it. To be quite honest, the proposal was to go down, I think, even to 400 feet, do the cap and the rest for those small areas if needed. They demonstrated that in the area with other ones, they had good flows from some at shallow, the rest deeper, but they were able to get it. The argument on it was the use, I'd say argument, the other side of that was those should only be used as a remedial alternative to not being able to get a lower well. That's the part that I didn't understand. Because when we all go in to put in wells in our house, which is kind of the same here, and you try to get estimates, the only estimate they'll give you is per feet. And if they have to go down 400 feet, they have a lot more than what you do. So I didn't know that about it only being used as a remedial kind of thing.
Well, I think what, and again, and chiming on this, but I think what Stephen Lahar was talking about there was saying that there are provisions in the Maine wastewater law that would allow a well to be placed closer to a septic system in outside, let's say, outside of the shaded areas that John's referring to, the small target areas, that the Maine Wastewater Act does, in fact, allow you to have a variance to move it closer, and that's usually remedied by increasing the casing and sealing the well, so that you don't meet the 100-foot, so you can go inside of the 100-foot setback that the state requires. I mean, these lines in here are basically, these shaded areas are basically 100-foot swing and 100-foot arc from the edge of the septic system. And where the septic system is, if they swing the arc 100 feet, I mean, where can you put a well? And I think Stephen Lahar and VH2M are looking to put it in a place that's not going to be within the influence of the nutrient plumes, the nitrate plumes that are projected to occur.
Yeah, I've got two questions about being an expert on wells or that kind of hydrology. First question is, with that little 10 by 10 foot spot, are you guaranteed to get water as long as you go deep enough?
Basically, if you read the C.B. Mahar report, they basically provided a series of wells that have been done in
well,
the area.
Yeah, but
it's a crystal ball.
You don't know what you're going to hit. You don't know if you've got seams there. I mean, maybe I'm all wrong, but I'm saying that's a pretty small chance. Maybe as long as you just keep drilling, you'll get it eventually.
Absolutely.
Okay. The second question is a little different. We've got that 100-foot exclusion zone from the septic system, yet if you're going down 400 feet, is that exclusion zone a sphere or is it surface?
It's two-dimensional.
It's two-dimensional.
So it's just horizontal distance.
But that's not how water flows, that's not how the septic system actually behaves. So does a septic plume move down? And does it keep moving down? And then, so it does?
Yep.
Okay, but a 100-foot surface is enough to purify it. So if you're going a 100 feet down, is that also enough to purify it?
Well, you don't have a 100 feet of bedrock, first of all.
Yeah, you have 3 feet of casing on the original well.
Yeah.
The bedrock's very close.
Right.
Well, what does that matter? It still travels into the bedrock, there are all those seams in there, right?
Yeah, you want as much overburden as you can get. And actually, some, you know, I don't know about the casing there, but I mean, we had some decent casing in some of the other wells. I think we had 20 feet in some places, and there's, and they also had the overburdens. We're 20 to 15 to 20 to 30 feet in some places, with production up to 150 gallons per minute, too, so. But of course, that was over Goose Rocks, which is in the nearby, but you're right, John, I mean, you're taking a, you're rolling the dice, you never know where the stuff is in the ground.
Because, you know, as you said a couple of meetings ago, there is no requirement to demonstrate that you have an actual flow of water in order to sell a lot.
No, and we, and
it doesn't have to be proven.
No, it doesn't have to be proven. When we do a standardized subdivision, we don't have to, we don't even get to that. We only do the 100-foot exercise. And the 100-foot exercise is a yardstick that the HHE uses.
What about directional drilling? Can you do directional drilling?
If you're going for natural gas, yeah. I don't know if anybody does that there. I think these are all straight wells and straight down. But you know, the only issue here is, you know, we've got small lots. We had a 3-acre lot, we wouldn't worry about it. We've got small lots, and so, you know, the board's the key requirement is, as you stated to me before, is to make sure that there's, in a small lot situation, it's potable, you have enough potable water for the for the project.
Is it permissible, again, looking at lots 2 and 3, is it permissible to put a well for lot 3 on lot 2 with an easement?
You could do that, I suppose. Sure. Whether it's saleable or, there's some.
Or is that part of
the decision? That's a business decision.
But it's impossible, it's not something that's not permitted.
No,
I mean, it's a public water, is that right?
No. I mean, people do that. They do it more with septic systems that I've seen.
Looking at lot 2 and 3, is there any requirement for separation of wells?
No, there's no requirement for separation of wells.
So, I mean, basically, they provided a plan that gives us the 100-foot setback. Mm-hmm. They've got the geo study showing that the area typically would have enough water, depending on distance. Drilled. I don't know what other requirement we could.
The question to the board would be, did they provide enough information to feel comfortable that you could say there's adequate water supply in this project? That's all. That's the only thing that you have to do. That's the requirement you have to do in the subdivision. And if this provides adequate evidence for you, then they've met that standard.
I think they've met the standard, whether or not it actually happens. I couldn't tell you, but I think they've met the standard.
Yeah. Is it permissible to put a wellhead in the setback?
Yeah.
It is.
Well, most of them are in the setback.
Yeah, so they all have.
So that opens up quite a bit
more feet where you could put it if needed. And as they said, if they're going to use the casing, there are variances to go close to it. Although that's the window that they've looked at and did your test.
No, it's an interesting point. I mean, why such a short footprint on lots 2 and 3, and given the nutrient plumes, and given the 100-foot setback? Any ideas?
What's that?
You notice how the well target areas?
Yep.
Are very small, but they're, and they don't extend outward.
There's one across the street.
Oh, that's one?
Yeah.
Okay, that's all squeezed.
Yep.
Yeah, that's the issue with, that's a problem with small lots.
And on second. And then with lot ten, well, lot one and ten, those well areas being right near the culvert, the road culvert, not culvert, I'm sorry, drainage, that's not an issue?
Could be, but it would have to be a sealed well. I mean, that's an issue to ask. I don't have a good answer. I don't.
I think they proposed to both.
They did. CB Mahar's report addresses specifically the well on lot ten and recommends that it be sealed and cased and protected.
And the septic, the reason why lot ten, the interesting thing for the board is if we proceed with this, then those septic systems gotta be put in those locations. I mean, it's that simple. Because there can't be any deviation. For instance, lot ten, it moves in any direction, it's gonna get over the property line on either side. And it's, you're gonna have a serious problem there. Not a serious problem, but you're gonna be violation of law.
Well, let me ask a question. Order. They put in the well first, they have a much bigger area where they could put in the septic system. That's the ideal location for the site.
I think this is a domino set here. Move something, it's gonna make the whole set move.
I think any of the water that's moved further away from that thing opens up more area for the septic. If it's moved closer, I agree with you. But anytime it's moved, and we have the 50, well, on some of the lots, not all of the lots where the wells could be moved, which would open up more room.
Well, if you look at lot ten, for instance, if you move that septic field closer to Scouts Way, you're going to reduce the well location. If you move it farther away, or to the left or the right, you're gonna push the nutrient pool over the property. And this thing fits, is a very tight fit. So it can't be any deviation.
We also have the issue with the wells on lots nine, seven, and eight. In order to locate those wells, you have to keep moving. You can't really grow trees.
So that will affect the buffer that's required. If you put buffer.
There is that issue. That's it, one of his.
We don't know right now where those wells are being.
Well, they're showing that well, they're showing that wellhead obviously not to cross the property, because then the well will be in the common area. So it can't cross the property. So in there you have a 25-foot area in which the well cannot be. Between the project line and the.
Why could the well not be in the common area again with an easement?
Because we require the buffer zone.
That's the buffer.
Yeah, but the wellhead doesn't impact the buffer.
Well, you're gonna have to clear it to it. Not very big, but you might have to.
Just enough of the truck that you have.
I think the applicant's intent would be to put the wells in lot 7, 8, and 9. In the areas that are outside the rear setback, it could be outside the 50-foot buffer. That was obviously the first question.
Right, that's the first place you try.
Yep.
In the case, right?
Yep.
I have to ask, these lots will be available to the sellers. This is what they'll be buying. I know it's a business decision, but if I was a potential buyer and I saw that's the only place I might hesitate to purchase the property if I knew that anything goes wrong, it might well it's going to be affected. So,
well, the plans are public information. They're available.
They're available, but I'm saying that as far as saleability, marketability, that might be an issue.
It's there if you do.
Yeah, that becomes their problem.
Yeah. Yeah, the board's concern is to make sure that the walls are...
Well, yeah, along with that, though, it's, I think, we're not requiring you to have 10 lots there. If there's one fewer, I think you have a lot more wiggle room, so...
Somebody in the public has a comment.
What?
Yeah, could you put your thing on the wall, or is people to see, or someone?
Sure thing.
You know, it's nice to, you know, have it, but you don't have to be talking about somebody else, you know?
How's that, sir?
Perfect. There we go.
Anybody else on the board have comments, questions?
No.
Can the board, even though we don't have it as a requirement of ordinance, can we put a condition of approval that adequate water flow is demonstrated on each lot?
How do I do that? How do I do that?
Yeah.
I'm the one who has to enforce this one.
Why is that a problem?
How do I do that? Provide, ensure that adequate water supply. I mean, let's say they drill a well and they're getting half gallon a minute. What do I do, say the slot is no good anymore, and you gotta, and it goes away?
Don't they have standards, you have to have so much flow? That's what I'm going, I think, isn't it 1.5 gallons per minute is the minimum?
I can't speak about whether there is a standard that the state said... The usual state says you absolutely cannot build on this because you don't have enough flow. I don't know an answer to that, Marty.
It used to be...
They put them into holding tanks and everything else, once the flow is established, that's what I'm saying. Well, I think our job is to look at the geology, look at what's in the area. Is it likely that there's going to be water in that area sufficient? How they go about getting that? And we can make sure that it's protected, and I think they've given an adequate plan with all of the cap. You know, they're not much more than, I mean, there's a million ways to take a little bit of water than a lot of water. They have one dissatisfied customer, and won't settle in too many more, and they know that.
Well, it shouldn't be a problem, and it's such a nice...
So close.
...location, it's such a nice development, I hate to have it go bad because there wasn't adequate water there. I can see where the problems come in as far as guaranteeing that.
Well, the only other, I mean, the other recourses are more extreme. And that is, remember, you used to require everybody to have a community water supply.
Yeah, that's got its own problems.
It does. And Tom's saying reduce a lot, I mean, it's the board's decision.
Well, the one time of the year, you got Gulf Brooks flowing pretty good there.
Okay, well, that's really my major concern, and I think CBMR has covered that pretty well. And the ditches being eliminated, I think, really adds to it, so that's a good move.
Tom?
Yeah, there is an issue in the report regarding Lot 8. Regarding the drainage ditch, and I'm not the expert, and I don't even know what the issue really is, intercepting the nutrient-loaded effluent.
What?
For Lot 8.
Are you in Wood and Curve?
Wood and Curve, second page top.
It's however, the town's concern regarding the drainage ditch intercepting nutrient-loaded effluent from Lot 8 and diverting it into the wetland should be addressed. I'll bring it to the table, but I don't have the expertise to go through it.
I'm sorry, but what page?
It's the very first paragraph on the second page for the Wood and Curve.
The last sentence, Pat.
I'm still on the...
Page 2, Woodward and Curve.
Yeah. Which one, 1, 2, 3, 4?
No.
It's
number 1.
Oh, I see it.
But the last...
Tail end of number 1.
Yeah, it's talking about, it appears the curving and catch basins have not been proposed adjacent to lots 8 and 9, but the grading conflicts no longer exist, however, the town's concerned regarding a drainage ditch intercepting nutrient load, that's why from 8 and drainage wetlands should be addressed.
But if I understand the plan correctly, there is no longer a drainage ditch, is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, they've got those new plans, they have those new plans when they said that.
Right. So, I thought this issue was new.
Well, let's look at that.
Well, and that appears to be right at the half point of the road, right?
Yeah, it's the half point of the road.
So, isn't flow going to go away from the road?
There was no ditch, ditch lag.
No, there's a ditch, if you look at the grading, you got a ditch, the ditch is pretty much in the shoulder.
There's a diversion of flow.
Yeah, it's in the shoulder.
The road profile.
Yeah, see, I agree with you.
So, maybe Tim, you can address that, you probably know better than we do, whether there is a ditch there or not.
The plume that is depicted for 9 and 8 on the original set of plans goes away from the road.
Yeah, the gradient is going to the south.
Right.
Actually, it's going to the west, south and the west. Yeah, actually more to the west, isn't it? It's like the point of it's at the west.
Away from the road.
I just read that engineer's report.
Yeah, when you read the engineer's report on that entire paragraph, the whole thing made me kind of go, what?
Oh, they're talking about 9 more than anything.
Right, lots 8 and 9 were located within side slopes of the roadside ditches. And they're saying that made the grading conflict should be resolved, and then they go on and they talk about, it was noted that the BH2M indicated that grading conflicts would be eliminated by installing curbing and catch basins. It appears that curbing and catch basins have not been proposed, but the grading conflict no longer exists. But
well,
we have this conflict.
They didn't go the full bore of doing the curbing, but they intercepted, they removed the ditches that could have potentially intercepted the septic flow.
I think what they're trying to say is that the ditch that was previously proposed outside of our proposed road could have potentially collected this nutrients.
Right, and
the request was we should look at that and do an alternative to make sure that doesn't happen.
Right. So you've done away with the ditch.
We've eliminated the ditch.
Right.
The road's now, the water's now collected on the edge of the road.
I mean, it was just
the way that they wrote it.
Yeah.
They said, we think you should do this, but you don't need to do that anymore because the problem doesn't exist. But they didn't say why the problem didn't
exist. I had to read it a couple times before. Right.
The reverse slope is not a function.
Yes,
it will occur from a drainage
standpoint. Yeah, no, I got all of that.
Thinking of the road, Ted, can you explain to us a little bit any conversations that you had with the applicant or their agent on that new road section, the proposed road section, and have you had any conversations with the public works director?
Yeah. Yes, I have. Well, you know, the public works director is always concerned about anything but a gravel or a shoulder. He's concerned, I think I said in my notes that PH2M is showing that you're going to put the type D and the type A underneath that.
Right.
And I did mention he probably needs a medium there for the grass to go on.
Yep.
But, and that's where Roger got a little upset with me. He said, well, that's where the mud occurs. But as soon as the tire hits that, you're going to get mud. I said, well, yeah. You will, but you also get gravel slung, and you get mud even in the gravel shoulder too. You know, the gravel saturated, it's going to get mushy and it's going to depress and deform. Not so much, but I mean the issue here, I mean the big issue of having the shoulder, yeah, it's to accommodate cars that are pulled over the side. I don't think we're going to get a lot of those. We will get them because people have parties and things like that. But you know the issue is protect the road, protect the base. I mean that's why you have a shoulder. Get the moisture out of the base, and that's why I was asking about the reverse slope and whether we can make that a little more extreme. Because it looks like some of these, and maybe it's just me, maybe it's this size, because this thing is not open. But it looked like the bottom of the ditch was almost at the shoulder in some places.
Yep.
I'm not sure. I'm a little concerned about it being near the shoulder.
not a deep ditch, it's.
No.
Like.
Yeah.
That.
Yeah.
We push it off, because you've got a big easement, you still have a big easement there.
Yeah.
And just be concerned about the water being in the shoulder, because that's your protection more or less from.
Right.
You don't want the water to get into the, underneath the base as much as possible, the shoulder's supposed to help.
So their request of the board was guidance concerning the grass versus the gravel. And if I hear what you're saying, for the shoulders, the grass is sufficient. And we'll do it if we get the right gradient off of some of these.
We proposed a grass shoulder, if you will. And we've done that. Our concern is the transport of sediment from shoulder. We're encouraging runoff from the road to be directed along the edge of the road and sent to the various stormwater facilities. Our concern is that by doing that, if we have a gravel shoulder, then we're going to be transferring that gravel down the road. So in order to not undermine the shoulder, our hope was to have it be grass, to have a little more vegetation, a little more stability of.
And from a homeowner's standpoint, if.
Oh, that's tremendous. That's a big advantage. I was just going to your conversation, because I personally don't know. I'm going to have to take the input from you guys. It sounded like you were saying to me that grass, you believed in this instance, was just as good as the gravel if, in those areas that you pointed out, there was a little bit more of side shouldering and a more dramatic slope.
Yeah. My feeling about the grass is I prefer the grass over gravel.
Okay.
I prefer it for a number of reasons. Sediment transport's one thing. The other thing is also I prefer from the standpoint that homeowners
are
very particular about, homeowners don't consider the right of way to be the towns or associations. They consider it to be theirs. And what they will find is, and this is just practical experience in the field, John.
Yeah.
I grapple with on a regular basis people who take Schedule 35 pipe and fill in an inch and put in a 4-inch or a 6-inch Schedule 35 or a Schedule 40 pipe, fill it in because they want a straight lawn across. They don't want a ditch. And that causes incredible problems because in large storm events, 25, 50 year storm events, that pipe can't handle that volume of water. And so we have flooding, we have erosion, we have serious problems. Homeowners will behave in a certain way, and the association is going to have only so much authority to be able to police it. So from a practical standpoint, owners want to see probably just a very shallow swale in there that they can landscape. Well, they can have landscape, and that's where the trees are going, you know, in that not in the shoulder, but off the shoulder. And so it provides a better image that these guys are going to want to have in order to increase their absorption rates and their sales. And we're going to want to see, because we want to have a successful age-restricted community. So I prefer this. If I think of what, and also, if I may just add one more thing, I know I'm talking too much, but all gravel shoulders I know always turn into lawn anyway. Usually it's crabgrass. Or
they live in crabgrass.
But at least it's maintained.
Yeah, well,
because
the grass.
And
then pretty soon the gravel shoulder disappears anyways, because they're not going to glycinate it.
My comment was to the road commissioner's concern of mud.
Yep.
If you have a gravel base with maybe only an inch of loam, and that's seeded, that doesn't get you much mud.
Doesn't get you much grass either.
It does.
Very trouty. Well. You're going to have to use a rye or something that can handle the drought.
Come by my way, and I'll show you some really good grass on 2 feet of sand.
So what's the question?
Very stable.
We're addressing gravel.
I just wondered what kind of grass.
So our question at this point is gravel or grass, correct?
Right. Yeah, the issue is, do we want to let them deviate? Because frankly speaking, they are putting the curb in. I mean, they're putting the shoulder as it's specified. On the typical cross section, they just put a little loam and seed on top of it.
What do you think, Mark?
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, absolutely.
Either Jason. you know that stretch on Old Alfred Road that they just did around the, where they cut out the ledge, where you come around the hill? So if you're going from your house, across the highway, and then over to Mountain Road?
Yep.
And they did that, I don't know if it was, who the engineer was with that, but they did like a same type of concept, but with about a foot of paved shoulder.
Yep.
And didn't know if that was something you guys had looked at instead of a widened, you know, gravel or grass.
No, they do a lot of that down south and make like that little paved, like little runoff or stormwater on the side of the roads.
I haven't seen that down south, but.
Boys from Virginia.
Don't pull that one.
Anything down south.
I think, I thought that was a very good solution to a potential issue right there, and I just was wondering if you guys had looked into something like that. It would help keep your road footprint a little narrower.
The road crew would be in support of that too.
Right, and I would imagine Public Works would care for it a little more. And it would eliminate any of the issues with erosion or anything like that at that interface between where you've got your V coming into place.
Yeah, that one's turned into pretty much traveling lane now.
It probably has. As they come around that curve, yeah.
I mean, over there, that's pretty flat. I don't know how much water flow we're going to get going down that road anyways. That's something that they've figured out.
I'm fine with grass.
You okay with grass? How about yourself?
All right, just on the cross-section, though, it shows that the at the edge of the pavement, the grass shoulder is rising up. Wouldn't you want it to slow down?
Well, no, you want it to catch that runoff. That's the whole idea.
So the water's coming off the crown of the road, and it's coming to the edge of the shoulder, and then it's running along the road. That's what we're trying to do.
The only problem with that is
sloping.
Okay.
Down into the
because when you catch the edge, when you're winging it, it will level it even.
Yeah, eventually.
After one wing, it's going to be flat.
No?
Yeah.
What do you?
Oh yeah, I mean plowing it, yeah, definitely. I do enough plowing, I'll agree. It'll probably roll that grass edge back. Yeah. So if it was flush to the top of the road, you probably wouldn't have that issue.
So why don't we just have a reverse slope there instead of eliminate that issue? Mm-hmm.
Marty, you okay with grass?
Yeah.
Jamie?
I prefer grass over gravel. I agree.
What?
Yeah, that's where you started.
I think you had
you got your green vegetation buffer.
Okay. Do you need a motion?
Do we need a motion on that?
No.
They just need guidance on
that. You've got your guidance.
We do.
And you got your green vegetation buffer.
What else do we have?
They got two other items that they want to
bring. Stormwater. You guys. And we address these issues that they mentioned about the stormwater.
Yeah, Wood and Curran, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, the comments that I see from Wood and Curran are very easily addressed, and we'll certainly do that.
Okay.
If not, by the end of this week, first thing next week.
Okay.
Before Thanksgiving?
Before.
Depends on how big the turkey is.
Yeah.
What other guidance do you need? Anything?
Let's talk about the landscape buffers.
Yeah.
Along Log Cabin Road, we proposed a 25-foot buffer along Log Cabin Road along Log 10, as well as along Log 1, and then the northern side of Log 1 through 3. And the applicant, it is a wooded site, as we all remember from the site walk. The applicant's intent would be to keep those as a wooded buffer that wouldn't be disturbed during construction. So I know one of Dad's comments is that he was hopeful we could discuss that this evening and you guys could give us some direction on whether you thought that would meet the ordinance.
Okay.
No, we're gonna have to go back out and look. We just stick with the 25. I thought you guys were going to make a point there. Quite a point.
Okay.
Well, here's the issue. Here's our issue. I mean, it requires 25 feet. It requires 25 feet and another 25 with no structures.
Correct.
That's true. Okay. But then it says that you've got to buffer views of the project within 25 feet. How do you do that? With natural vegetation. Depending on vegetation. Here we have a lot of conifers, which is good.
We have a lot of trees.
We've got a lot of trees. A lot of them are up and they're under doesn't exist. So the question is, let's go to that. Let me read it to you. You should have quoted it in your notes. But the question is, how do we do that? Maybe we need a staff and the applicants and the engineer need to go out and pick it up. What we got, because I don't remember.
They would be at what, 70%?
Well, remember it. First of all, I would suggest, everybody got their ordinance? Let's see if people want to know.
Yeah, I know.
All right, first of all, let me find a section, but you can look up the definition of buffering. Okay, remember that. That's something you guys decide what the term buffering is. You've got a percentage range to go with, 66 to...
It's 84B11.
Yeah.
That was one. Thank you.
You have the new one, so now you can have it. I bet you're excited. Yeah, 84B11. It said 25, as measured from the exterior boundaries of the development, shall contain evergreen shrubs, trees, fences, walls, or any combination that forms an effective visual barrier. To be located on all exterior lot lines of the development, except the streets and driveways, shall be kept open to provide visibility for vehicles entering and leaving the development. That's comforting. But it's that key word, effective visual buffer.
Now, well, the question for you is...
Barrier. Sorry. Okay. Barrier sounds...
Question for you is, simple and plain. Does it have to be seasonal? Non-seasonal. You can put Rosa Pagosas all the way down through there, and that is leaving a barrier. It doesn't say how high it has to be.
Well, visual barrier kind of implies you can't see the project from an adjacent...
Why do you want to hide it in the beam then? Your most neighbors, look at most neighbors. They don't go plant things along the property line so they don't have to see one another.
In the property lines along lot 1, 2, and 3, and then tearing down a lot 4 and 5, have quite a bit of white pine understory already. Then there's quite an overstory canopy. That's a pretty thick buffer. It's... The buffer along Log Cabin Road is much thinner. There's a lot more larger oak trees. There's really no understory.
There's no understory driver.
No, but that's a problem. There's a...
Yeah.
The trees themselves go back a lot, and those trees are big. So I think if you're, and I can't remember exactly, but when we went out on this site, the base of those trees themselves, not the tops, really obstructed an awful lot of what you could see behind them. I mean, yeah, you can at places, and that's why we have other, what we know, 70% or 90% for buffering, to achieve.
What? Yeah, I mean, although we don't use the word buffer here.
Yeah, no.
Who uses it? We're all using the word buffer. They're saying visual barrier.
Yeah.
Trees, walls.
And this is the part of the regulation that we haven't got to change, right?
Correct.
We changed the definitions of the screening and buffering.
Well, we gave something you can hold on to. We gave actual penetration. We gave a number you had to hit.
Yeah.
So how much gap you can see through. So yeah. The applicant, when they're told to screen, they know what they're to achieve. And the issue for these guys is the same question of how much do you want? Tom and me had some real concerns about the neighbor to the south and the proximity of their house. You also have the out sale lot, which is close too.
I mean, that would be the only lot that I mean, looking at from my point of view, that one really needed something. I think in there the out sale lot between it, that was kind of open. So that one, the other ones, and I know, but I do know that this is buried, but I really believe in one day, when that was written long before me, and I've been here a while. I mean, the intent was to, you can see from house to house, almost everywhere in a run, it's, let's get up some trees, let's get up some bushes, let's not have, where you're looking at some big parking lots, there aren't any big parking lots proposed, no big buildings are proposed, you know. I guess it's the interpretation of what that barrier means in this particular subdivision.
And that's your, that's the planning board's decision, I'm not defining what constitutes a visual barrier. How do you achieve this, what are you looking for to achieve this, besides painting it green?
Yeah, I know.
But you look at his son's building, there was no barriers there.
Before the chain.
Which his son, you mean, Bartlett Farms two?
Yeah.
Yeah, but they're 1,000 feet back from the road, in a tree line, and you can't see anything.
What road? They have their own road coming in.
Yeah, but from the outside, from the project line, the buildings were 1,000 feet back and behind the tree line.
Well, so you still can visually see them.
The problem with seeing.
You should use a different example.
The problem with saying barrier, and this says visual barrier, if it's a barrier, you can't see anything on the other side. And that's a little overdone.
Yeah.
I don't think that's what was intended.
No, I don't think that's what was intended either, but that's what a barrier means. I'd be looking at it going, yes, Jason?
Arundel Estates, Lombard Road, is that before your barrier ordinance or after?
I think it was before. This ordinance was 2008?
No, it was after.
Was it after?
We had the same 25-foot.
They had more 50-foot there, as I recall.
The 25 and 25, which.
I was just looking at that the other, yesterday, 2 days ago.
Where is it that we have that 7?
You can see every house from Lombard Road in Arundel Estates.
Yeah, it's not necessarily from coming in, you're not gonna do that. It's from the adjacent properties, is what the intent is, that's what they're saying. I think from your standpoint, on 10, 1 and 10, you don't wanna put a buffer in there between the busyness of the road anyways.
I mean.
Log cabin's gonna be oriented towards Scouts Way, because that's where the end, that's where you're coming from. You probably don't wanna put some buffer there along that road.
The only thing I would say, along the road there, you would put something of that nature for the simple reason of noise for traffic, okay? Not for visibility or anything else, but you turn it, if you have the bushes or whatever outside, it will cut down the traffic noise.
That's 500 feet of connected vegetation, knock it, and sound down.
You got 25, 50 feet you're talking about, just turn around, if you put it there, you're cutting down the noise.
The reason for this requirement, though, first of all, I agree, we can't have a full barrier, so that won't happen. But the reason why we have is to protect the interest of the existing properties. And no one would want to have, well, we're all used to having woods around us, and then all of a sudden you lose it. So looking to have, just to mitigate that, so that it makes it so that whoever is gonna be building a development, they're not just gonna, we're forcing them to care about the neighbor, that's all we're doing. And we don't care what they do on their street frontage. If they wanna have a busy road, that's their choice. It's just the existing properties and the homes that belong there.
But the existing property doesn't have a current owner, as far as I know, you haven't sold that house, right? So that's a new sale as well, so it really doesn't matter.
Well,
Could you buy what you get, you know, whatever you see?
Well, that is an out sale, I mean, we have to consider that from that part of the project.
And it would have made it easier if that was part of the whole development, because then we wouldn't have to have the safety buffer. But if all else,
It's been in and out 3 times.
So as far as the 25-foot buffer, all I would like to see is what's there to remain there.
Right there on Lemon Road.
That's between the outside.
Between the property north and south.
Yeah.
Yeah, not along Log Cabin Road.
That's up to them.
That's up to them, but it's against the existing abiding neighbors.
And that's pretty heavy with white pine.
Yeah.
All understory, it's all 10 feet tall, probably.
Yeah.
Real thick white pines.
That part would do the job.
But that'd be a year-round buffer, natural buffer.
Yeah, green.
Yeah.
So how do you gentlemen feel about it?
I'm comfortable with the 25-foot undisturbed around the perimeter of the property, the lot lines.
Okay. Marty?
Leave it natural.
Yep. Tom?
Yeah, I'd keep it minimal. I don't see much need for buffering here.
Tom?
I do with, if I was that property that is just south, the most property.
Tom?
Oh, on that side, yes.
I would say, Tom, in fairness, I don't think you were there at sidewalk, okay? Take a look at it and see what we have there, okay?
Oh, that's why I said it.
I mean, that's the only reason I'm saying it is, when we were at sidewalk, and we saw existings, we remember it as the old scout itself, but where they're doing it, that's the only reason I'm saying it.
Well, you're also, there's still woods there, there's still trees, and once, the property owners can do whatever they want to their property. They can cut every tree down. And once that happens, then you may not have such a feeling of a buffer anymore. It might just be a clear view.
Well, if the property owner cuts his trees down, he does not come complaining about a buffer.
Wait a second, before we sort of add on.
This is the new lots.
Yeah.
It's about the existing neighbor and existing.
Right, but that's the question that we've got to answer for that.
So I'm all right with 25 feet, and then I see they want to have 25 more feet of a no structure zone.
No structure zone, yes.
Email detail.
Yep.
And we've done that before.
25 feet, you're telling me, cannot be cut.
Right, it can't be done?
Can't be cut.
Can't be cut.
Right.
Yeah, but that's, see, the thing is, it's inside their lot, so it's gotta be a cut, that's gotta be a covenant. It's gotta be a covenant. So it's 25, you know, it's 25 feet in their lot, and then another 25 feet by buildings, so.
Yeah.
You got a narrow building window there.
That's a tricky by enforcement.
I'd ask if that helps, but I'm not sure if it.
Well, they've shown it on it. I mean, you know, if you look at lots 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, they show that. But then, that first 25 feet is gonna be no cuts up there.
Yep.
That's in that.
And well, I mean, all of the.
The one also on the plan.
All of the open space will be left undisturbed, right?
Right.
Other than minor.
Besides the trail.
Things that you guys are, looking to go down to the brook.
Yep.
Okay.
So in summary, then, the only real buffering we're concerned about is to the north and to the south. And to make sure that neighbors to the south are properly screened and the outsale to the north is properly screened. And then the rest of what you're proposing sounds like it's satisfactory to the board.
And, well, I think what they're proposing, if we use the term like you're using screening, instead of the barrier that's in the current one. Our current definition is the application of visually, something that visually obstructs 33% to 74% of the land use activity. And I agree with that was more of the intent. This was to visually make it more appealing than being able to get through.
Right, so we could use that as guidance for north and south.
Well, I would be comfortable with using that, and I think that was the intent.
Well, you can't use both. You gotta choose one or the other. I mean, we're basically saying we're creating a 25-foot no-cut zone around the perimeter of the property.
Mm-hmm.
And you start saying, well, we gotta do this barrier, I mean, that's talking about supplemental. You're talking about supplemental in areas where there's insufficient amount of vegetation, I mean, we can't use both those terms.
Well, I think that.
Because that's not.
There's two different requirements. There's a 20-foot,
there's a 25-foot area that requires the screening, the 25-foot that they propose is inside of that 25 feet. Or 50 feet total, is that not correct?
We proposed 25 feet of undisturbed area, then the building setback is 25 right back from that.
Right, that could be lawn. So it's a 25-foot no-cut zone, period.
Yeah.
But if you're saying, if you're also bringing in the visual buffering, then that's supplemental.
That's the outside 25 feet, not the lawn between the building and the buffer.
Right, but the solution to meeting the standard, the board is saying, the applicant is proposing that meet this standard, they're proposing that there be a 25-foot no-cut zone around the entire of the property, including intruding in lots 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1 through 5.
And 10.
And 10.
Over 10, that would do it. 30, you know, that's got to give you 34%.
Then you got the open space to the south of 10, 9, 8, 7.
I think as long as that's reflected on the plan now, right?
Yeah, they had to, in order to get the clustering, they have to take the amount of area that you're getting from the clustering, which is actually pretty impossible considering we're doubling density. You really can't. Like, what we're getting is we're almost getting 50% open space, correct?
Yeah.
So that is a goal in the rural districts, if you recall. In the open space, they talk about achieving 50%. Technically, the R3 is a rural district. So they've met that standard. Yes. I don't see how, when we give double density, there's no way that we can say that what they're getting back in a smaller lot translates into open space, because that
you are getting 50%.
Yeah, we're getting 50%. So that's just a hard calculation to make.
Is there anything else
variable?
Well, and Ted, I would recommend a note be added to the general notes of the subdivision plan that stipulates that the open space will remain undisturbed other than areas where they're cutting a trail down to the brook or other caveats that are necessary.
Or
so that way it's clear on a plan that's recorded and everybody has access to an alpha.
Right. Safety.
Well, whatever, yeah.
Because you may have that open space, but if you got...
Well, yeah, if trees getting ready to fall on somebody, you want to be able to... They're different, caveats in general, in undisturbed buffering language.
Well, you guys are going to get to see that, because the applicant has covenants to the board for review. So,
how's that coming?
If you guys stop spending my money, I could give it to the lawyer and get it written.
We spent your
money. Haven't spent any money yet?
Come on, make it money.
Okay. Is that it?
I hate doing it.
Let's see, is that
everything? My fire hydrant.
Yeah. No fire hydrant, everything's.
Are you guys all set?
Everything is on the note.
Can we get a public hearing next meeting?
It'll be in October, in December.
October will be perfect.
Yeah. October of next year.
That was better.
It'll be when?
Be in December.
Why not next meeting?
Because our next meeting is strictly for ordinance work.
I can't advertise by the next meeting. Hey, Jason, no.
Yeah.
I can't advertise until the next meeting.
You don't get that.
7 days. I have to advertise that. And I have to put it in the paper. So, it's December.
On December.
Tom and post on the ground. Sorry, I missed that. What date were you looking at?
Looking at first
December 12th. Is it 9th or 10th?
12th.
12th.
3rd.
10th.
Oh, for God's sakes. It's going to kill all of us.
For the public hearing?
December 10th.
Public hearing December 10th?
Okay.
December 10th. That's the only meeting we have in December.
Yeah.
No, you have one December 19th, 17th.
17th?
No. 17th?
Yeah.
I put it in.
You guys basically, let me explain something. You're supposed to get all the ordinance changes done by the first of the year.
Yes.
Okay.
But that's, but that means that on the
17th. And illnesses in the normal course of business.
But that means that on the 17th, we're not going to
be. You don't get it. You can't review.
Because that's not a normal meeting.
That's right. That's the only bit I could get.
We don't have a holiday.
The normal meeting date is the 10th.
So that's a public hearing.
Well, I mean, we got to ask you on the 12th.
You got to learn to say it's 3rd.
Set up the...
We're tied it up to...
Move on to the next item?
Public hearing.
Okay, moving on. Yeah, Mark.
We also want to meet the 3rd for a public hearing. We did it for...
We're doing ordinances. We're not going to get bogged down and doing this kind of other stuff in between. We've got to get the ordinance coming.
Just to have a public hearing.
We can give them the public hearing on the 10th, which is the 2nd.
Yes.
At the regular meeting.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. New application, Motorland. Yeah.
Did you read that?
Okay, this is map 2 lot 1, right?
Conditional use application, 60 by 200. Now, this is the building that you told us that you were going to build way back when you said we had to have a fence.
Yes, this is the fence block.
Right.
Everybody have this stuff?
I think so.
Everybody have notes too, right?
All right, Paul Gavwood, I'm doing the site plan for Motorland. The applicants are here this evening, so if you have any questions for them. Yes, as you all know, the applicant wanted a 60 by 220 building for storage of automobile storage. The building is located towards the rear of the property. Building will not impact any wetlands. There are some wetlands immediately adjacent to the field that was done back in the part of the 70s. So not impacting any wetlands. We are just concerned about the buffer. I think that seems to be some issue as far as the existing fence going along. I got the fence going along the property line. I get the planning board last meeting, they wanted the fence to be 8 feet off the property line. Either I heard on that or didn't quite understand what was going on, but I'm showing a stockade fence, 8 foot high, about 2 feet off the property line, going from Portland Road. I'm showing it back in the tree line. But I guess the TAD's comments that should have been 8 feet off the property line.
Yeah, I believe that's how it was.
I guess I'm not sure what that was about, I guess.
Sorry, what are you doing?
Well, let's take a look at it.
On the property line, which left 8 feet on the...
Right, of pavement.
Of pavement.
I guess check, maybe I can say...
Pavement extends out 8 feet, but the fence is right on the line.
Well, you know, a foot or so off the property line, so we can maintain it, you know.
Hold on, before we say that, I'm still getting the notes, I'm still getting the 5 revisions.
Yeah.
What they were in there.
That was a big issue.
Right.
Easement to maintain the fence was also a requirement.
Yeah, right.
But it was right on the line.
Yeah.
Okay, while we're figuring that out, Paul...
Keep going.
So I guess I can just try to go through some of these comments that TAD brought up. I'm sure you guys are finding as far as parking circulation. I think TAD was suggesting that, I'm looking at parking lot landing, I'm sorry. TAD was suggesting that the larger parking lots should have some sort of island, trees, you know, planted islands to soften up the total area of paved parking. Guess I'm not sure what they mean by large parking lots. I think a large parking lot is, I'm sure probably not having this town yet, is Walmart and Shaw and Hanford and, you know, you're getting 400 vehicles and, you know, you're trying to soften up that huge park, but I don't consider it a large park lot. I guess the survey's discretion is whether it's a large. If Pat suggested that either we retrofit the existing paved area, or put in some islands in there, or possibly, or put in an island where the existing pavement ends and our new pavement begins. You know, obviously that's not going to be visual really from Portland Road, it's just going to be more of an internal aesthetic issue, because, you know, all the display vehicles parked out in the parking lot.
I'm going to stop you for just a second.
Yeah.
This says that this is a conditional use application. The application is not complete, so I'm not sure we should even hear it.
Oh, really?
We have precedent, we've rejected other people for not giving us a complete application, and I don't think that we want to create that issue. We have a letter from the town planner that indicates that the conditional use checklist has not been submitted.
Oh, is that correct?
What's that?
The conditional use checklist has not been submitted with the application.
Yeah, I don't have conditional use checklist.
Then I don't think that we can hear this application, it's not a complete application, and we set precedent a couple of months ago by rejecting an application that was not complete.
A couple of months ago.
Over a year.
Well, no, it was in August.
A couple of months.
It was in August, we rejected an application that did not have a conditional use checklist attached to it. I don't think we should be hearing this.
But, yeah, I was just saying, we rejected applications before that for not being complete.
Oh, yes, and I'm saying that because it's not, I don't think we should be looking at it.
Chairman, I have a conditional use application checklist.
Is it filled out?
Yeah. Amazing. It's even checked.
Okay. I was just looking at it, and the letter says it's not here.
It wasn't, but it is now.
Where was it?
Just filed.
Okay.
And, you know, in all fairness, the applicants, what the applicant gave you to fill out as far as what was required, checklist wasn't in the application's packet.
Okay.
But, you know, I did go online today and download the application, supplied the checklist.
And I think...
Certainly, I went through the checklist to develop the plan.
Yeah, I think because we have the checklist, I'm willing to look at it and say, it's okay, I'm going to leave that up to the board.
I'll make copies for you. Do you want to circulate this around?
In the past, we didn't have it, and we went, and the applicant did not bring it to the meeting.
That's a good point.
Absolutely.
Yeah, well, glad you have it.
Yeah, so am I.
Me too.
Although that doesn't mean we have to stay with it.
So that was the only incomplete item, Tyler?
He's got to give me a narrative describing the project's compliance with section 97H, which is the, my goodness, is this a 97H right here?
I mean, you know, that section is just...
Okay.
Yeah. And the...
Well, I mean, you know...
Okay, is
yeah.
The defense?
Well, read what that says.
Okay, I'll circulate this too. All right, so we have a narrative. We have a 97H, and... the applicant does, in fact, I gave you an addendum, that the applicant does, in fact, have a PNS, I'm sorry, that was stuck in a map,
yep.
And I unfolded the map and out came the PNS.
Can somebody explain to me, I'm glad we have that, but I went through the, who did own it, what was separated, who is the new owner, can we just have that little bit of discussion to get me back on page one?
Okay, what's the question again?
Explaining ownership because of, at the time...
Exhibit is the entire parcel?
Yeah.
That's right, they haven't actually...
They haven't done the...
They haven't conveyed anything, right. There's a survey sketch or that was done by NATO Land Survey.
Right.
The applicant's proposing to... How about Griffith Autos? Neil Griffith still owns the property, probably still in deed. They're proposing carving out the section to be sold to Motorland and retaining 4 acres for future sale at a later date. So it's still owned by the entire property. Right now it's owned by Neil Griffith.
Was it done completed today? Because we had, I think today was the 12th.
The 1031 fell through?
What's that?
The 1031 fell through? We tried to push it out to was it last week? Because we were looking at a 1031 exchange.
It did not happen.
Oh, that sucks.
Okay, the purchase and sale agreement is the same person that owns Motorland in the front now, where we just approved, is also going to own the property where this building is going? That wasn't clear.
I haven't seen the purchase sales agreement, so I'm not sure what it says.
The inset box where the improved on, that is what the purchase and sale agreement's for Motorland.
Okay, but we're here about a new building that's going on.
In that box.
Same insert box.
Correct, you see it in the.
Inside the purchase.
Okay, so the purchase and sale agreement's for the other, right?
Well, right title and interest is that you have a right, you have a right to actually bring this application forward. You're not developing somebody else's land without.
But without the purchase and sale, we don't know that.
And reading the literature, it sounded like the insert box, not the out, was going to be cut again to make another property for this building. That's not the case.
No.
Okay, so the purchase and sale just shows the right title interest to the whole entire thing with a agreement to sell that outer. I'm good. It was confusing reading through it.
Well, I have a question to ask the applicant then. So is Motorland still the applicant, or should be Neil Griffith at this point? Since you didn't close today, I take it, so.
Well, he's not the purchase sale agreement, right?
Yeah.
I mean, Motorland is intending to purchase that piece of property from Neil Griffith.
Right, right. If they have the PNS, yes.
They have PNS, so they have a right to do the application.
But we don't.
And the application vote.
So just.
I'm looking at the PNS right now.
So just because the closing did not occur on whether it was the, you know, that division of land is.
Yeah.
You have a copy of the purchase and sale there?
Yeah, I do.
We don't, okay, because we don't have it in here.
Yeah.
No, because I only got one copy.
Okay.
Yeah, which is fine.
You've got the copy, that means.
I have the copy.
We've got the we've got the checklist, we've got the 97H. Okay.
So you're going to have, we have proof of financial capacity and also cost estimates.
Yep. Then I'm good with it if you pass that back and get that copied out. So we do have a complete application.
We have a presentation.
Okay.
Yes, please.
Yes.
Left off of the parking lot. So you were discussing the new parking area that's going to be added.
We're not really adding parking area, we're just adding another access drive, so we can access doors, different garage, three different doors located along the building. They're really hard to see in this one right now, but one here, and there's also a door along here, which for some reason this plan didn't really show up very well.
Well, the light gray is all existing.
The light gray is all existing.
And the darker is.
The darker is in the post pavement.
But that's still the spire, except for the building.
Well, it's actually labeled as parking. It's customer parking.
Additional. That's required. So right now we got five customer parking spaces.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, when you try to do the numbers and you're trying to use storage and trying to come up with how many cars you really take me by the ordinance, you need more than five. So the applicant has certainly ample places to have additional customer parking if they need to. They haven't had to at this point, so obviously we can put display vehicles here and at certain times. Need more customer parking, we just have to increase the customer parking area. So right now, this is dedicated customer parking, and this is overflow that they should be.
Although, if I may ask, just from the practical business use, that idea is that it's circulated, that you need to bring the cars in at night and bring them out in the morning. So having any customer parking area or any dedicated parking space is not what we're intending to use it for.
It'll be a driveway by any chance. Pardon? You don't need a driver to pull them out, do you?
Does this building generate more customers, or is this just solely to store the vehicles and...
It's safety storage.
Yeah, it's just an unconditioned warehouse building.
This is gonna be heated though, right?
No, okay, I don't know why, I know.
You should tell him that.
I saw that.
So it's cold storage only, no heat, there's gonna be internally lit. As far as the lighting, you know, you have a lighting plan done by JM Lighting. The only new lighting we're posing, we have a couple of 3-foot entry doors. We're gonna have behind the wall, you know, entry light near those doors. That's the only, we're not adding any wall packs over the doors. We're just gonna have 100-watt entry light near 3-foot service doors.
LEDs?
I think they're gonna be LEDs, right?
That's what they're now, so...
And so we can certainly in the future supply that to the exact light fixtures we want. You know, they're gonna be 100 watts to that. So again, we're back to the so-called possible island, you know, and we're hoping that the planning board will allow us not to try to put a little grass strip right here.
You thought it was a good idea this afternoon.
I did. But you know, for a couple of reasons, it's not really gonna be a visual from Route 1, called the cars parked here. It's not really gonna be a visual thing. It's gonna be kind of a little maintenance issue when you're trying to plow it. Obviously, it's nice to just have, you know, pavements so you can plow right through. And also, you know, just for maneuverability for getting in and out of the doors, you know, I don't really want to lose more space as far as, you know, the maneuver the cars in and out of the building. So we'd like to hopefully, respectfully, not do that. I know Ted brought it up in the landscaping standards.
Paul, how wide is that new stretch of pavement between the existing
30 feet.
Building? 30?
Right here? Yeah, 30 feet.
So that pavement is really just for transporting? It's not really designated for parking at all?
No. Nope. I mean, the time you try to get your car, there's a door here. There's a door here. It's gonna be a door right about here, and then we have another door from here, and then we have another door at the end. So just to drive around and access the car and get them out and not have to move the display vehicle. So it's more of a driveway aisle.
I think that what you're gonna need to do is get rid of that designation that's customer.
The board's having five.
What that triggers the requirement that you can't drive through in our ordinance. You can't have drive through the block.
You wouldn't be drive through there anyway.
Drive through here to park, and it's got to be further.
I can take that up. It's not a problem.
All right. How many spots are we parking? Five.
According to the notes.
Well, you know, if you look at the ordinance, which is, you know, definitely storage, you're supposed to have, what, one space, maybe 300 square feet?
And it's because of the storage, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean...
In one space?
For 300 square feet. No, that's the other one. That's in your next one.
For warehousing? It's per employee.
The ordinance for parking.
Here we go.
How many cars are going to be parked inside the building?
It's managing, yes.
How many exactly?
Roughly 80.
I mean, so there's potentially 80 parking places inside the...
You know, it's sort of crazy sometimes.
Are you angling?
Nothing that says parking inside the
outside. The intent
is inside.
No. Well, yes. The intent is to create sort of parking zones based on what would be 5 doors, so that we'll never be more than 2 deep to get them out. Just from a business, we lose a lot of productivity just having.
I was wondering.
Some will be this way. Some will be that way.
The at the angle so you can drive through, pull in this way, then that way.
I call it the warehouse.
I know, cold winter time, it's like putting sardines.
Yeah, yeah.
Last line?
One space would be right on the sewer, so.
Do it that way. Yeah.
You see where I'm at?
So I know, I'm trying to.
What section is that, Tom?
Wow, that's why it's got all that parking.
Page 79.
It's one space per 500 square feet of gross floor area for business. Per business, doesn't sound like warehouse.
Yeah, so, I got 26 spaces where I need to do that.
Well, then you need that parking spaces there.
No.
Well, if the ordinance says it, he's got it, so why are you?
There's something wrong with that.
There's something very wrong with it.
For example.
5,000 square feet, maybe, you know what I mean, but.
It's usually for employee.
Yeah, but now guess what, he has that inside, so there's a parking space inside.
You look a lot, what's going on Southern Marina?
Tim, you want the customers parking inside?
Parking.
You want your customers parking inside your storage building?
Sure, they're all his customers, because guess what, he doesn't own them all, they're customer vehicles.
Yeah.
So I'll be there.
Yeah, that works.
So, I mean, this.
I'm sorry, I know it's a circular.
No, it's getting you in a circle. I mean, so. I just had to do the calculations, right, I'm supposed to do the calculations?
Yeah.
I did the calculations, I don't think it's right.
Right, it's there.
You know, and I think, you know, that's all he needs.
We also have parking on the right side of the building.
Well, you know, that's customer parking, employees park, you know, there's.
Actually, I think when it was kind of northern, that was the main customer parking area.
Right.
Because you came in from the side.
So, you know, obviously employees aren't parking, there's just a sort of customer employees who are parking this area, and maybe files. But, I just designated that they have plenty of parking, so.
Yeah.
You did, I'm trying to say.
So, you never had to play that game.
Just leave it like that.
Question, parking spaces, this is storage, we never had to do parking spaces for Southern Maine Marine.
Guess we screwed up?
No, I'm just saying. Because you aren't driving it.
Well, that was, yeah, warehousing wholesale,
Wholesale. See that?
That's why we didn't do it.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't wholesale.
And this is.
These aren't wholesale either.
Right.
So we go back to just one space per employee?
Get a handicap space.
I think that makes sense.
He's got a handicap space.
Yeah, have the handicap, have the employee parking designated over on the far side. Five, that's one for 500.
We're gonna put the employee handicap parking all the way out in the back, for the next.
Yeah, that's for exercise.
I know, right there in the front. Well, they're not gonna be able to drive any of those antique cars anyway.
Sure they can.
So it's actually illegal.
No, they don't have attachments so you can drive anything.
Tim comes to see us, it's a different vehicle.
Actually, there's a long history in classic cars of helping differently able people be able to drive, with the President Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
That's true.
Right.
A good history.
Okay, so I think that solves the problem, though, because it's not wholesale amount.
Right.
So, you know, that's gonna solve the problem in terms of parking.
The staff is not concerned with it. Boy can do what you want, but the staff is not concerned.
Okay.
The only.
How many, well, they only have about 80 cars, so they're talking about three spaces.
And that's what, and that's why, that's the standard we use.
Yeah.
To begin with, coming up. And they put in the five because the.
Motor vehicle sales.
Automobiles, yeah.
Yeah, motor vehicle sales.
So they're good.
That's what they're good on.
That's one for 30.
And that, and. So how many display vehicles?
Well, they have, he said they have about 80 vehicles, so you're looking at three spaces.
Three spaces.
So
So leave those five, leave the handicap, leave the employee parking off to the right.
I wish I could move that note.
Yes.
Actually, staff had no issue with the more parking. Separated.
Oh, he brought up the issue.
Yes, he did.
They grade you.
I don't know who brought it up.
You did.
You put the note on.
Hey, we don't bring this stuff up.
All right, let's see. What else do we have? We have, so we've got lighting, we're gonna provide some cut sheets on that. Utilities, one of the utilities coming in. Applicant wants to know if you got a waiver on the putting utility lines on the site plan. Since there are no utility.
Yeah, no, I'm going to actually, we're gonna light up the building. So we're gonna have somehow, since this same building, but that underground.
Underground?
I was asking for a waiver of existing underground utilities. I know where they were supposed to have gone, but I haven't paid the site plan. I have no idea, so I don't really wanna put on this site plan where I had them originally shown, because they may not even be there. So, and I showed all you about ground utility, but whether, how they went from this water shut off to the building, they go the way I showed it, I have no idea.
All right, I'll make a motion, we grant that waiver for.
Existing underground.
Existing underground, they're already there, it's not more.
Right, you're not making any changes except that.
I'm just gonna add this one.
You'll add that, yeah, just so, my motion's for the existing, we have to add that.
I'll second that.
Motion that has been made and seconded to waive putting the existing utility lines on the plan. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Yeah.
Motion's unanimous.
This new footprint of the building, that's all on gravel, right?
That's my opinion, Ted has a different opinion. I was out there surveying the property, obviously, there are some cars parked in this area right now. The grass is more like weed than grass, I'm sure if you're looking at the photos, it probably looks like a grass or some sort of cover, but this is and was all the existing gravel area that's kind of going more of a weed than anything else, so I still use it. I still treat it as an impervious area in my calculation, so, and by running the calculation, I treat it as impervious. The new building located in the existing impervious area didn't have a net increase in the post-development flow, so I guess we can visit that, I can revisit that again, add some little lawn area in here and see how that does with the calculations, I've got to do that. You know, certainly, you know, I talked to the applicant, you know, we haven't addressed some of the issues with Ted, you know, obviously this water coming off the roof, you know, but, you know, we don't want that to dissipate under the ground and cause erosion, so we are gonna put in a 3-foot, you know, crushed stone drip edge on the entire back of the property and discharge that to adjacent wetland. And we'll also do the same thing out front, you can handle the whole thing, but we can certainly, you know, put in some crushed stone areas between the doors. Catch a lot of the roof running off in the building except for just where the entries are, so there's 3 entries on that wall.
What are you doing?
We'll do the same thing, it'll go into undrain, and the undrain, just undrain, discharge it. So we'll send it into an undrain system. So that'll definitely help the stormwater runoff from the site, because we'll be collecting in the drip edge. So certainly we can, willing to do that. And that'll answer some of Ted's questions as far as possibly erosion.
That was my question.
And you fill, you have about, what, 2 feet of fill for the, bring it up to one?
Yeah, what I did was, you know, I matched, you know, existing pavement, I came out at 2% slope, and by doing that, coming up 2% slope, I set that elevation 104. But, you know, there really isn't much I can do with it. I got a sheet flow this forward from the building, because obviously the building's level. So this location, the 104, that location, that 104, that location, that 104. So there isn't a whole lot of drainage that can get going in either the north or south direction. So I got a sheet flow back over the existing paved parking, which, you know, it's been working very well. There isn't really an issue as far as the stormwater runoff on that parking area. I'm not talking a huge parking area, you know. Normally, you know, rows, 352 catch basins, so, you know, we can certainly accommodate, it's not a lot of distance from the sheet wall. So certainly it's gonna go, it's gonna come down through here. This is a catch basin right here, so some of this water obviously collects in this catch basin and goes back out to here, and then there'll be some sheet flow probably around. And this, some of this water is actually gonna go in this direction, because this is coming back down, so I'm sending it back in that direction. This area, we've caught in that catch basin, so we'll have this area right here, which is sheet flow.
And that's the only real addition. Back one. Yeah, this way out front.
It's gonna come out to this.
Yeah.
It's gonna come out there.
It'll go in this direction, right?
Yeah.
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 So this area is pretty much part of the catch basin.
Yeah.
We're talking this area coming down toward the ground. And you know, the natural condition, the ground pretty much heads in that direction anyway.
You said you were going to provide calculations for that?
I did.
Yeah, he's got some, he's just gonna change a couple of variables.
So I can look at it a little bit more.
He's gonna change the coverage numbers.
Right.
Ted, your concern over whether the building is on gravel or not?
It's impervious surface versus non-pervious.
Okay, and that would change the calculations?
Yes.
Does it change them by much?
Don't know, that's why I asked.
Okay.
I don't think it'd be very much.
What determines whether it is pervious or impervious?
That's always been a debate.
Well, I was told anything you drive on is impervious. So if you park a vehicle on even loam, it's impervious. Anything you're driving on or parking on, you're pretty much making it, making it impervious.
I always disagree with that.
What else do we have on this?
I think your grass is not impervious.
Do you need any more direction from us?
Yeah, the buffering and the fence.
Fence is good where it is.
Fence stays where it is. Right in here, we need some buffering.
So I know I.
Because you don't have any.
I brought the fence itself, would that be inadequate?
I built the fence into there.
Well, I brought the fence to, originally the fence would end right at the parking lot.
So you're gonna continue it all the way there?
Well, I did, but I'm not sure if you'd rather do buffering or do fencing.
Yeah, it would probably be a private cost.
I think fencing would be the way to go.
Yeah. Just run it down a little farther.
Yeah, well, that's what I got.
To make them look the same.
Right. That's our problem solved.
Yeah, so I must have misunderstood, I didn't know, I went right from the road, right from the tree line with the fence. But I just figured that was trying to get a buffer, though.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I thought you had a line.
Needs to, we're parking up front and each end.
Yeah, and right here.
That's it.
I should probably just terminate with. Probably should be the god on the circle.
Yeah.
Oh, that's it.
Say a lot of public hearing. How's that end of the way for you? Complete application?
Blue lines. I just had to move my border.
Which way is that?
So hopefully that will solve the buffer issue on that side of the.
See what I'm saying?
I do. And that's why I did.
With the fence?
The fence.
Yeah.
Fence goes along, and then you have the paperwork to back up.
I'm not sure if had any other issues as far as buffers on the other end.
No.
No.
Okay, so we've got the buffer issue resolved.
Yeah, but I showed the fence to here, at the tree line.
Bob has a question.
Yep.
We're coming to the end of this, and one of the next stages is going to be public hearing. And one of Ted's comment was that you guys hadn't provided the abutters list. Yeah.
Do this afternoon.
I have it right here.
Busy afternoon.
We're gonna make some, I'm not speaking for anybody, but there's a couple of steps.
I didn't even have to show how to do it.
There's a couple of steps that's gotta come, and if we don't have that, the answer's a little different. Okay, thanks.
Okay, good.
Just a question.
So.
The consultant was very responsive.
Yes.
Thank you for the recommendation. Mr. Flannery, is there anything else from the board point of view?
No, we just need to make, take a look at that stormwater. You got the buffering there.
Public hearing. Well, we got both. We gotta look at it.
Sidewalk, public hearing. Yeah, you wanna look at it.
Okay.
So what are the sidewalks? We were just there.
That's right.
We just did move it. This is.
Yeah, that's.
This is going in the building.
You're right, I wasn't there for that one, so I'm sorry.
We did a sidewalk.
Yeah.
There was a sidewalk done on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, you guys are all asleep.
You weren't looking at the building.
Yeah, we weren't looking at the building, so.
just.
I don't think we need one.
I'm gonna leave it up to you, but I think our precedent says that we.
I don't need it.
The sidewalk.
Yeah, well, we did a sidewalk because there was a lot of changes that had to be made to the front of the building itself and the electrical and all sorts of things.
Three years.
Oh, you talked about the original.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Not for this building, this building, this is the first time it's been before.
Yeah.
I thought you wanted for the.
You're right, this building is the first time.
No, for the fence?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
I did.
That's on official sidewalk, because.
Yeah.
Right, sure is.
Okay, so I.
The pavement hasn't changed any.
Hey, guys, before we look at the idea of doing the sidewalk and having the public hearing, I need a motion to deem the application complete.
I do, deemed it complete.
It's a motion?
A motion's been made to deem the application complete.
Submission requirement.
Seconded application.
Hold it, Marty and Tony.
Right, so all of the submission requirements have been met, and we have enough information with which to make a decision.
Correct.
So the application has, the motion has been made and seconded to deem the application complete. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Was that a, did you have a discussion point, or is that a yes?
I was going to, but I said yes anyway. I'll get it when we get to the final anyway.
Okay.
I don't lose this stuff.
Then just, we have a complete application, then we can proceed from here. So we should schedule a sidewalk, and we should schedule a public hearing.
In dark early.
And that would mean that the earliest point would be the 10th of December.
Can't see at night.
For public hearing?
For public hearing, it would be the 10th of December.
You gotta have your sidewalk before your public hearing.
When are you, are you guys available the Saturday before that to do the sidewalk?
Well.
Before the public hearing?
Question is.
Well.
Okay. What, we don't know between now and then?
Well.
That, no, no, I'm just.
I understand that.
I'm just saying is.
You know, that's gonna be one of those issues.
That's there for everyone.
You know, it's an issue no matter what time of year or where we're going.
Marty's got too much sugar, he's afraid he's gonna melt.
So let's look at.
This is being recorded, gentlemen.
That's okay.
We're talking about December 5th.
I'm not doing anything nasty.
We're talking about doing a sidewalk on Saturday, December 5th. What time would you gentlemen like to go out there?
Can the applicant have everything staked out? Yeah. They're gonna have.
Or sooner.
Staked out.
Or sooner.
Sooner than that runs into the issue of Thanksgiving week, because this is right after Thanksgiving.
I'd say it's.
This Saturday.
Well, I think this Saturday we may not be able to notify.
Right.
And I'm not available, I'm not available.
Yeah, notification.
I'm not available.
We get the next Saturday.
Is it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're talking in about 16 days, 16, 17 days from now. No, 20 days, sorry.
Okay, so we have the Saturdays, we have the 20th, the 27th, which we don't wanna do, but there is the 21st, the 5th. You guys wanted to do it on the 10th, so one of those two.
Yeah, I was thinking the 5th.
The 5th?
That works.
Does that work for everybody?
What time?
I think so.
9 o'clock.
9 o'clock? 10 o'clock?
That's one again.
I don't know which one, Rogers.
Here in December, December is over, honey.
10 for black powder today.
Time?
9.
9 o'clock?
Yeah.
Okay, somebody wanna make a motion?
Make a motion, you can let the sidewalk for Mortal Land on December 5th at 9 a.m.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Motion has been made and seconded to have a sidewalk on December 5th at 9 a.m. Any discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Coffee and donuts are good.
Rogers?
Coffee and donuts are good.
Bob? And the motion is unanimous. Gentlemen, we will see you on December 5th.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Would you take the second?
9 o'clock. 9 o'clock, Marty's gonna have donuts.
Oh, I mean, you were supposed to have a whole morning.
A whole day shot. I gotta get up for 9 o'clock, wait a minute. It's the one day of the week I get to sleep in.
You
anything else?
No, I got one more.
Oh, okay. Next on the agenda. No, that's okay. ServPro, plenary site plan application.
You got my thing?
You're up again. Yeah, this is just the plenary site plan application, not the complete site plan.
So, plenary is the complete.
Well, no, the other one said, I'm sorry, the other one said conditional use. That's what I meant with plenary.
When you go home, sir.
Okay.
So I guess we really need the application.
Yeah.
ServPro, right?
I think you need to change that to ServPro for the Sonco. Since that's a corporation.
The legal name is exclusive, I think.
Okay.
But franchise name, this would do a business. Not technically, it is a franchise, but basically, the business is ServPro.
Okay.
We need to establish right title of interest. Corporations here.
What's that, sir?
We need to establish right title of interest, that's all. That you are in fact Spruce Circle Inc.
Yes.
Because that's what you showed up on the property.
Right.
Maybe Paul needs to probably change that application to Spruce Circle.
I mean, I had the applicant as Matt Lisa, of course, who did. Called the project name was ServPro.
Right. So, probably needs to be, the applicant needs to be Spruce Circle.
Yeah, that's the name that's on the deed, yeah.
Right, Spruce Circle owns it.
Yep.
Are you off, who's the officer, who's the president?
I'm the.
So only the officer should sign it as an officer. So the signing application as an officer of Spruce Circle.
Yeah, I think that's rough reminder, we'll take care of that part, I think.
Okay.
When you sort of deal with the property.
Well, those were the people who were there when we went along.
They're everywhere.
They seem to be fairly interested in this.
If they don't own it, I have no idea why they're there.
Get your fee if you can. Also, the applicant has paid the fee for the administrative site, for the plenary site plan.
Okay.
Our records are now complete if you were in.
Site plan checklist, we've got.
Yep. So once. What we don't have is the site plan checklist, but let's proceed.
Do you have it, Paul?
He has one right there, checklist.
So I figured he probably had it.
You know, went through a checklist, we'll put it that way.
Chad, I wanted to make sure that you had this payment though, because.
Yes, we do.
You did, okay.
Yeah.
I know.
I've got the receipt here.
Substitute.
That's what I'm wondering, because we paid this back in October when we paid so much. I'm hoping the money is showing up.
Site plan checklist was that.
Yeah, let me see it.
That's what I used.
As a checklist.
That's kind of what I was given, but.
There is a checklist.
There is a checklist.
You don't mind that.
Not really.
Their personal responsibility.
That's always been that way, it's just that what's due online is we had to change.
It's not a complete checklist.
What we gave out.
But it is a checklist.
It's a.
Yeah, but it's not the right one.
Responsible need to be specific to the job that being done.
I guess I would, coming into this project, we've already had a meeting with the applicants. I'm not really sure what the applicants submitted in the past to get to where they are today, so, you know, we're trying to, you know, proceed in order to get the planning board's comments and concerns as far as you propose, you know, site they were proposing for access and buffering. It is an existing structure. through my checklist. So, are we waiting?
I think that...
Are we waiting for someone?
No.
Nope, you're wrong.
I can't speak to the rest of the board's concerns, but my concern is the setback from, that is required. Are they gonna meet it?
Well, you know, I guess, you know, I was told by the applicants that at the sidewalk, that you guys would work with the applicant, so...
Right. So, how are we gonna work with it?
So, I guess, what, obviously, you know, there's an existing entrance, there's two existing entrances on the site right now. DOT gave the driving entrance permit to use this one.
Yep.
DOT did talk to the applicant saying that I guess you can move it 100 feet, is what you said, either direction?
Not 100 feet, but 20 feet.
Okay.
Either way.
Because site distance, you know, obviously, it's a straight run, there's no problem with site distance, and obviously, by moving in between, actually, this new driveway's kind of between the two existing driveways. My thought was, you know, we had this driveway in this location, obviously, he's got two garage doors he wants to access. So, with the driver being here, I can actually pull up, back up, turn around, and back into the garage doors. So, that's why I thought it's gonna drive it where it is. I know I, you need a direction, if I go here, I still have to serve the buffer strip. So, I said, rather be in this area, if I'm gonna serve the buffer strip, because it makes it, at least try to make it more usable for the applicant to get in and out of the garage.
I don't have a problem with the driveway being there, but would DOT have a problem with the driveway? If, because if they said it was at that other spot and you could move it 20 feet, that's more than 20 feet.
Correct. Right, yeah, we have the visual, plenty of visual, that's the only thing that...
Yeah, you got lots of visual, there's no question there. I just didn't know if DOT would have a problem with it.
Because that's why I explained to them. To be this side or this side, to be the middle, there's probably plenty of visual.
So when I was looking at the other, I said, you know, that just, you know, that's something I can work with. I can pull the truck and pull in, the truck and back up, the truck and pull out, the truck and come in, back into the garage, loading and loading. So, I still got, I have to disturb the buffer either here or in this direction. The only additional disturbance for the buffer, you know, obviously, if I came in this area, you know, in the same scenario, I would disturb it here. You know, I guess, and then the reason why I'm for 10 feet is because I designed this thing to actually handle a UPS truck. So, you know, even though the applicant stated that they probably could have UPS deliveries to their house, I just think that, you know, any commercial site should be designed to handle a UPS truck. So then I put my turning temple on here, that's what I needed in order to get the UPS truck to come in here, pull in, UPS can back up, and leave. So, I want to make sure the UPS truck doesn't park along the side of the road and or try to back into the property. So, that's why I came up with temple buffer. Certainly, you know, maybe I can make it 11, but you know, that was pretty much what I thought was minimum that I needed in order to get a 30-foot box truck or UPS truck coming in and out of that site. I guess I probably could, you know, increase the buffer in this area 15. I think, yep, and might be okay with that to a certain point where I can get the UPS truck and then to come back, pull up and come out. I'd have to relocate the parking space though, because you know, I was told we need 5 parking spaces, that was because the number of employees is 5. So I'd have to, you know, obviously add, or I think the applicant said they actually, employees could park back here, you know, instead of adding one here. So I probably could make, at least try to improve that buffer in that area, 15. You know, I probably could, you know, improve, I guess, this buffer here to 15 right here. Just, you know, obviously, whatever I can, right? Again, I might be able to get a little bit more here, but I need to be able to get the UPS truck to back up and leave. So, you know, maybe it's possible to get a little bit more buffer. I really, really look at turning radiuses. I can probably tighten up a little bit. But this is the critical area right here where I need, in my opinion, only 10 feet just so I can truck to make that left turn. So I probably can increase it here to a certain point. I certainly can increase it, you know, here, you know, to a certain point, and then maybe just have the additional parking towards the rear of the building. I guess I'm looking.
I wanted to add just one little thing, that if we move parking spaces, we'll have to cut down more trees, and so we were trying to keep from having to cut down more trees and use the existing space for the parking spots.
But I think, as Matt said, if we go back here, you know, you wouldn't be cutting any trees.
No, but if we move it back some, you know.
Well, the buffer is 15 feet, right?
Correct.
The requirement is.
What's the ordinance requirement?
25 feet?
15 feet.
15.
Your setback is 15, the landscape strip is only 15.
I think when we went to the walk, and we were all talking out there, I see absolutely no reason that they can't meet the buffering requirements to the left and to the right.
Right.
To the full 15.
And when you were out there, this is all gravel, this edge of gravel right here. This is all gravel.
Yeah.
You know, obviously, we're gonna loom and see that area and bring that back for us, but, so it looks probably a lot worse than it will be when you finally finish.
What we're wrestling with is, yeah, what we're wrestling with is, you know, the requirement does say the 50. However, given this site and the deeding that went on to make that a conforming lot that didn't have the appropriate setback to begin with, I think that would necessitate, not necessitate, but in this one, on the ground, says it's no longer possible to do the full 15 and have safe vehicular traffic in and out. So you gotta somehow balance those, you've gotta balance those two. But where you can achieve the 15, I think we have to reach it to the maximum, my own personal would be that we have to achieve that 15 to the maximum, and I think I shared that with you when we were out there, to the maximum extent possible where they still can enter and leave safely. How that's determined, you know. Sure, I mean, is EBS truck the appropriate truck?
Yeah, that's.
That seems suitable to me.
Yeah.
What's that, 30-foot radius?
Yeah, 30-foot box truck. So, yeah, so we're not having truck trailers or semi-trailers going into it.
Oh, you follow what I'm saying, Ted?
Yeah.
I know you probably don't agree because it's.
It's not a question of agree, it's a question of, I don't think we can alter the ordinance requirement, but I mean, you know, if you're, it's not requiring a stripping us in a driveway access.
Right.
So, yeah, so just get creative.
How much pavement do you have in front of the building? 20 feet?
Okay, let me check it out right now. I have from the building, I have like 24 feet.
24 feet?
Yeah, 23 and a half, 24. Yeah. And when I ran the template, it's pretty much what I needed, but.
Yeah.
You know. There is a building overhang, but it's, you know, it's above the trucks, so it's not an issue, but I just didn't feel comfortable with, you know, making it less than 10, but as far as a GPS truck driver, maybe I can get in and out of here, I just wasn't comfortable. I ran the template, it's pretty much what I needed to make that turn. You know, obviously, maybe I can, you know, DOT is allowing that to be 26 feet, so I guess that might help widen that a little bit.
That was part of my thought.
That would help maybe the turn, I can look at that, so I certainly can look at a couple different options, say how I can maximize 15-foot strip. So if I made that, you know, 26, and maybe I made that radius 25, you know, maybe I can really, really minimize the impact on that strip, and I'd be more than willing to do that. Unfortunately, I will need to have some number less than 15. But I don't know how much that is right now, but this is what I proposed. I didn't think that would be six.
You could do 26, with the Route 1 specs. We have specifications for driveways in Route 1, or Route 111 and Route 1, if you recall, you guys were. So you can go to 26 on that.
And that's consistent with what the entrance permit says.
What are you showing there, Paul?
Right now, I went 24, because when I read the ordinance, 24 was preferred. And so, you know, that's what I started with. But, you know.
Do you help?
Well, I think it won't hurt, that's for sure, you know, obviously I'll have actually 2 feet of width.
Do two more, a little bit more with the radius.
A little bit more room to make the turn, right? I didn't really look at it, 26, it's gotta be a plus or a minus. And maybe making that radius a little larger.
I was gonna say, how about a 40-foot radius?
Yeah, exactly, maybe make that radius a little larger. So, you know, if I increase the driveway width, and then I kind of increase the radius.
That's what I think you're gonna, that's what.
Maybe I can save a little more of the.
Now, you guys are paving in that back, little back corner, where it makes the L in the backside of the building?
No, the well is there.
Yes, no, other side.
The well's on the other side.
Yep.
There's a stone wall.
What is, what's the, what are you putting right there? Nothing?
There's a stone wall there, isn't there?
Just access to get into that one spot. Can't that be a parking space back there?
Well, you don't really need it, you could put it right in that.
Well, if you extend that proposed 15-foot buffer and take that one out, that's in between the handicap aisle, and move it right back in there, then you've still got the spaces.
Yeah, I think we're, yeah, so Matt and I talked about that, I don't know if Lisa was present for that conversation, she probably was. But, you know, we lose that space, and I thought we could put it in, Matt said, you know, certainly they can park back here.
It looks like you've got, you know, a lot of asphalt back in behind there to be able to utilize as a parking space.
Actually, it'll be a funky parking space.
Yeah, there's a thing that is.
There's nothing not funky about this one.
Does the town have a maximum driveway?
Maximum driveway?
Because I believe DOT will allow.
26, we just looked up.
I'm just looking that up.
I can give you a divided driveway there. You're 100-foot radius.
Nobody ever asked about maximum driveway with.
Actually, we got, well, actually, our standard, we do have a maximum radius. Yeah, it's 26 in that. I'm pushing it, I'm saying they're gonna have more than 26 vehicle trips per day, I'm assuming they will.
I think I covered.
Oh.
No, no, yes, you will.
That's fair.
Truck goes in and out, that's, it's two trips, right?
13.
13, but you got five people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Five people coming.
You're gonna have 26 trips. So they're a medium intensity as a result.
So.
Which gives them a wider radius and a wider driveway.
So you think those ideas will work?
Yeah, I just think that I'm definitely gonna have to have something less than 15, you know, somewhere, right?
At the radius, would you?
I certainly can.
As you taper in, on a 40-foot radius.
I can certainly work on and really, really maximize the 15-foot buffer and minimize, I guess, maximize the buffer.
I think it has to be to the.
And actually, that would be actually better.
In order to be able to.
Like a box truck, it actually says.
We still try issue.
I think that little extra bit here will make us, you know, right, so.
Do we have a maximum on the radius?
Yeah.
There is. But that's more for.
That's why they do more than 26 trips a day.
Right, there was language in the, yeah, there was language in the ordinance that said.
Seven. It's 77B.
That's true.
And we're over on. Boom.
It was like.
I should read my own notes.
So they're good as far as.
Just check, because looking at it, it's not right.
They don't need.
40 feet.
They don't need that.
Right.
Preferred radius of 30 feet, which my preferences change. Medium.
Yeah, medium.
Volume driveways.
Right.
40 feet.
But Paul, if you widen the driveway and give that larger radius, that gives you a whole lot more maneuverability.
Yeah, I figured 24 feet, because, you know, it said preferred with the 24, so I started with that, and then...
But I'm thinking you might even be able to bring that buffer strip right out to where the radius ends, because you have that much more maneuverability.
I might be able to.
John prefers 24, but Bob prefers 26.
So 26 is fine.
John prefers, they both prefer 26.
Yeah, I just think that'll help.
You have a range in the ordinance, and if you meet that range, I'm okay with it. My only concern is with the other, that we, in order to really try to follow the ordinance as possible, is for that buffering to be the maximum extent possible.
Here's another reason why. Question, are you being serviced by trash pickup?
Yeah.
They pick it up on that.
Well, why I'm saying that is because those are bigger trucks, and they need more room.
Actually, 30 feet.
But they pick it up out on the road, right?
Are you gonna have a dumpster?
That's what I'm saying, dumpster.
Usually dumpsters are on-site.
Yeah, but you still gotta get the truck in there to get the...
That's on-site where the loss is occurring.
Oh.
Oh.
Off-site, sorry, yeah.
I was thinking dumpster that you need to be serviced at the property.
No.
They're just gonna, you're gonna have normal trash out on the road, and that's what I would assume.
On the road, you throw your trash on the road?
Right down 111.
We let it fly.
I wonder if it slows down.
It blows down.
We just put on backup driving.
Okay, so I think we have that well resolved.
Okay. What else do you have, Paul?
You know, we'll come up with the lighting fixtures that Tad requested, and cut out, and cut sheets, you know, for the project. And then stormwater management, me and Tad have discussed stormwater management, but I'm not sure the board cares or wants to hear about it, but...
Of course we care, Paul.
I did look at the project. The project, if I remember, probably is about a 20-acre watershed, you know, because obviously this goes uphill, quite a ways. So this is actually located at the bottom of the watershed.
Yeah.
You know, so the watershed is kind of running all down, everything kind of drains either to this ditch and to this existing 24-inch culvert, which goes on Alpha Road. It's got a lot of storage here, you know, the inlet to the culvert is like elevation 157, the road is at like 164, so, you know, I topoed that area, it's off-site, right? Topoed it just to see where I have storage volumes. I did do some quick calculations, so you have the watershed. Just to see if it was gonna impact the culvert, and it didn't, I didn't have to do post and pre-development flows off the project. I know, talking to the applicant, you know, there, he was not telling me that, you know, most of the site was already disturbed, but I know Tad looked at the aerial photos, and it looks like it's mostly revegetated, I can't tell you how it was in the earlier stages. But I looked at the aerial photos, and I kind of could look at what was there, and I eliminated what I thought was building and gravel, and I came up with a net 2,000 square feet of new impervious area for the project, which is pretty minimal. It's located right adjacent to drainage ditch, topo runs hard in the southwestern direction, certainly not impacting any neighbors whatsoever, pretty much discharges to the ditch and to that culvert. And then Tad was suggesting that beyond that culvert, I guess you know more than I do, I didn't go beyond that culvert.
Yeah, this is stream level.
This is
a pool of ponds. It's actually a large watershed, this isn't...
Yeah, this is a pretty good watershed right here, yeah, it's like 28 is the thing I remember.
Well, right up behind you, Phil Levy has a pond.
Yes, exactly right, it comes to the pond, and actually the pond has an outlet, it comes to some sort of catch base, and that catch base discharges back into here.
Correct. And that's an artesian well that feeds that.
But it all works well.
Yeah, well, yeah, right, there's nothing to complain, nobody deals here, anything, so, I mean, and the project is right immediately upstream of that culvert, so this watershed is gonna be gone before you have watershed gets there, so... You know, I guess I can run a larger set of numbers and try to prove that, and that's what the board wants us to do, but, I mean, you know, it's just, no impact of the downstream property, the water goes right into this huge storage area, and then discharges the MDOT culvert.
Well, I for one, I'll speak for myself, I would need some sort of calculation, and I would sure work with the investment, that would work into that, so that we'd have something from which to make a decision, so that a full analysis, stormwater management would be required, this is business. I understand your logic, I followed it all, I'm not sure about.
Well, we need some storage for the culvert.
Right.
But you can explain to us in that.
Yeah, if I can run the analysis just to show that we're not going to exceed the capacity of the pipe in storage, probably that is far as we need to go, but I'll look at it. You know, as far as pre and post, you know, getting them right, I think the water's gonna be gone if we ever wash it, is there? So it's just a matter of plugging in the all the impervious area and the fields and the buildings that, I guess, Sean Juson has up there, and libraries, there isn't a lot of development in that area, but a lot of big watershed. So certainly I can do that.
So that would be no waiver for the.
That would be no waiver.
Well, it's not a full, it's still not a full stormwater management plan if he just does the calculation to show just the impact there.
Well, I mean, he'll do it, if there's no impact, he doesn't have to do an EO plan. If there is an impact, he has to do.
Correct.
Is there such a thing as a low level?
Yeah.
Calculation, because that's really all we need.
Well, yeah, it's.
That's what, rational method.
That's what I'm. But I need.
Yeah, it'll analyze the watershed, analyze the impervious area in the watershed, and the fields, the woods, and the forests, and, you know, different areas of the watershed, and see how see how that culvert reacts to the watershed.
Yeah, because I know mine down by my house doesn't react very well.
Yeah.
We're done.
Your stuff, you know.
So, you know,
All surf from.
It's hard to work.
Trying to get you there.
Is there anything else that we need?
You're good with landscaping, right?
Yeah, as far as landscaping, I think we're gonna put four trees there too, right?
Yeah, some of us.
We chose those trees because you mentioned it the last time, so.
Yeah, you know what, it's not, I don't know if it's the best for you. You can look at some other stuff, I don't care. The only reason I mention is because they're pretty hardy, but, you know, you get glacial till there, you can put any number of things there. They don't react well to salt, that's the only thing they don't do well to.
But we don't use salt, maybe.
Yeah.
One eleven. Yeah, they do.
Yeah, it's white.
They don't need.
My house is white.
They don't need salt on 111, it's in the water already.
That doesn't affect the vehicles.
Anything else?
Okay.
I'm all set, Mr. Chairman, have any questions?
Do you guys have anything, anything from the board?
What's the next step?
Well, we've done the sidewalk.
Yeah, we've done the sidewalk, we need a public hearing. Yes, no?
Is it complete?
Can I have a public hearing?
We gotta determine if it's complete before you can have a public hearing.
Right, and Paul's gotta revise his plan.
You're right, he's gotta give us some changes on that.
Okay.
Okay. We will wait for you, Paul.
All right.
So it looks like we're.
When's the next official planning board meeting?
December 10th.
December 10th, so two weeks before, so that's not today, right?
It's, no, it's, I think it's 3 weeks from today.
3 weeks, okay, good.
Yeah.
Two days.
We both know what that's like.
Yes. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good.
Thank you.
4 weeks.
4 weeks from today.
Why?
2 weeks from Thanksgiving.
2 weeks from Thanksgiving, 2 weeks.
So we have plenty of time. He has plenty of time to do it.
Yes, he does.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can just stay up to 11:19.
The next item on the list.
Clients and boards say that all the time.
The next item on the list is going to have to be tabled until next week. It's the next item on the list, gonna have to be tabled. The ordinance. We're not gonna get anywhere.
Motion to adjourn.
We're gonna table the ordinance review until next week. And then we'll hear your report.
You got it.
Get a report.
Here's the weekly calendar. We're meeting every week, it seems. I filed our appeal. Checked the bridge. Filed the appeal on behalf of the planning board. We had the ZBA. They needed it by Tuesday. We had approximately 41. Another series of arguments was dumped on my doorstep on Tuesday. Monday. And what that did is that, so they introduced some more arguments before ZBA. And I tried dealing with that, but I just said, no, can't. So I filed a very short appeal with ZBA. I think I sent it out to you.
Yeah.
Okay, so you've all seen it. Except for Marty, who doesn't have email. And I didn't include that in your packet. I'll get you that hard copy. And that's going out to the ZBA members, so we're meeting next Wednesday, in which to, that's the next Wednesday, right?
Are they going to walk out of this one, too?
Probably not.
16?
No, no, 15.
This is...
Wednesday is the 15th.
It's the 18th.
Well, yeah, 18.
It's the 18th, yeah. It's the 18th, we're going to have the hearing, so please be there, 7 o'clock here. And it's regarding again the August 13th decision by the planning board. Another 80K has been filed with the courts.
What's that? 80K?
Notice of violation.
Okay.
No, excuse me, it's a land use violation that's been filed with the courts.
Is the ZBA at 7 o'clock?
ZBA is 7 o'clock here.
On the 18th.
Yeah. On the 18th. And so, those who are aware of it, we also had the selectman had a meeting on Monday night with the commissioner of DEP about the odor issues.
That was the commissioner?
That was the acting commissioner. That's her.
You are kidding me.
I hope he doesn't become the real.
All right, I'm sorry.
I don't know how to respond. I shan't respond.
Yeah.
Okay.
Take the wiser of the two courses.
And he wisely just basically listened and said, we're reviewing everything.
And I know nothing.
Well, no, he tried to explain that there, since there's actions pending, he can't say very much.
Right, he can't.
Seeking out his legal, just like we had to, seeking out his legal alternative to the adjutant general.
He could have done better. So...
Yeah, and it was a thin crowd. There weren't many people there. I don't think there was a lot of those. But, so that was done. Let's see, Tuesday night, we had complaint committee. You know all about that.
No.
Well, complaint committee has decided to just wait in on a couple of other issues before they start attending our meetings. They're not going to do much this year except help us write the residential districts and the rural conservation. However, they are going to, they are grappling with the, they've brought back the, what's now called the Trailhead District, which we call the Eastern Trail District. And it was proposed at Tuesday night's meeting that it would extend the entire length of the trail.
Say right now?
20 feet wide?
Yes, probably. I'm going to be producing maps for the committee. So the committee knows, you know, where real accessibility is, you know, where viability. What they want to do is provide an opportunity for somebody to make some money from the Eastern Trail. However, of course, it's got to be in a place that A, is accessible, and B, probably has access to other clients besides those on the Eastern Trail, because that's not exactly a booming population at this time. It will be in the future, but right now, it's you don't want to build a business based on that.
They hope that it will be in the future.
Well, your tax dollars are going to fund another big section of it. New Hampshire's going to fund 4 miles, they say, on our side. We'll see.
That's about the width of the state.
No, it's 30 miles. 32. So anyways, the, that's other applications. Phil Abbey's gonna be bringing back, he's very close to his 6 month, yes, remember Phil?
Yeah, Rocky Ridge.
Yes, no.
Ledgewood.
Ledgewood. There's a Rocky Ridge.
And he was really gonna move on this one too, wasn't he?
He was. Yeah, Paul just filed that with me today, that's why I said, Paul, this, and this is an incomplete, he sat down and did them all of them sat there. So, but he's filed, so we'll be bringing that back up for review.
Now, that'd be for final subdivision review?
No, that's for preliminary.
Preliminary, yeah.
So it was, all right.
So basically, Jay Group's gonna get their preliminary before Phil does, at this rate. Phil's been at it for 4 years and they've been at it for 4 months.
But Phil is coming under the old ordinance, as I recall, which is.
No, no, he's not.
Did he file before that, what, that got passed or something?
Yeah, but nothing's really changed. I mean, he actually would benefit from the current, from the new ordinance. From being in the AR district, he benefits because his whole project's in the AR district. But he couldn't do a residential subdivision in the AR district now. And so his filing prior to the meeting meant that he could do a residential subdivision, and that's the last one that's gonna be allowed in that district. So, and maybe he might decide to make them commercial lots, because they can be commercial. I'm not sure that's the kind of visibility somebody wants for a commercial lot. Great place for a campus, can you imagine having a nice little camp? Nice office building back there on the edge of that cliff we'll go over. Good place for Sierra Club.
I could use that for clients who get me the turf. I could show them how to leave.
This meeting is now, this meeting is starting to deviate. That's all I've got. There's nothing else, except Marty's got something.
No, a couple things. Turn on how Season Cottage have turned on paved their whole entrance. Going in.
Yep.
I mean, and some of the other work, but we've also lost another business, Nothing But Things, down in supposedly the new.
Nothing, it's Nothing But Things, or is it Nothing?
Whatever it is.
Yeah.
Which we wanted to create that new business zone, the Gateway.
Yep.
They're gone.
What, the antique place?
Nothing,
yeah.
Nothing, the antique place is selling up.
Yeah. Sold out.
Did they sell already?
Oh yeah, it's listed. It was 7th and 8th.
Wow, it went quickly.
It's a beautiful house.
Yeah, it's
a beautiful location.
But the other thing is, we were told point blank, when we passed the ordinance, the sign would be moved to the Gateway or at the entrance of Arundel. Again, never got done.
But that's an issue for the selectmen, not for us.
Didn't say that.
I know, I realize that, but you know, it's a valid point, but it's something that the selectmen have to address.
We were told that they would jump on it right away.
Well, then they still got plenty of time for them to do it right away.
And nothing on the fire hydrant, I don't think yet.
The only
that has been presented to them, they know about that.
The only thing I would ask. We've got the ordinance review. Let's look over everything that we've got right now so that we don't spend a lot of time next Thursday going through it. Yeah. You know, if we can get it reviewed and get our questions all lined up, that would work quickly.
Have I given you 6 through? I'm just really bogged down in 5 right now because first of all, I don't have time to work on it, but I'm bogged down in the floodplain. Because it's all messed up.
And, yes, we've got what, 1 through 4 now?
You got 1 through 4. I think we need to jump on 6 through 8.
Right. So.
Well, if we could do 6 through 10,
yeah.
In December, and do the same thing, get it, review it, make sure we've got everything covered and we understand what it looks like,
right.
So that we don't spend a lot of time going over it again and again and
but
again.
The only thing we were doing is formatting. We
have right. Format.
We can't change anything. Do you like? But I realize we can't change it, but we've got to, if you like the format, if you don't like the format, we need to make that decision.
We figured, it took a while before we settled into a format that seemed to make sense.
I think I put that in the minutes, didn't I?
Mm-hmm.
You did.
Okay.
Yeah.
And if that works, then it shouldn't be a long process to go forward.
So specifically, what are we doing? Are we looking at particular sections in our meeting next week?
Yes, sections, well, whatever that, 1 through 4.
We haven't finished 4.
Okay, so you did 1 through 3.
We were trying to get us through 4, but we couldn't make it because we were past 10.
Okay.
Okay, so then we.
I thought you knew what to do with that.
Yeah, you said, fix the rest of it. I think it's, so maybe we did go through 4. Well, 6 through 10 is the next.
If we're through.
And we won't do all 10.
Because at the end of 4, you, we were gonna change, I can't remember, one, we had a sentence and that was the exceptions, we talked about the exceptions first, and you were gonna reverse that.
Yeah.
And then it would fall right in line, that's the end of 4, right?
No, that was, that was the definitions, wasn't that?
Yeah, that was the definition somewhere.
That was the definitions for solid waste, wasn't it?
Okay.
Never mind, forget my comment.
No, it's okay.
Yes, it was.
We're jumping all over.
We did get into 4, I've got some markings here that are cryptic.
Well, let's finish up 4.
Yeah, we'll start with 4.
We'll start with 4.
And then we'll jump over to 6, and I can give you what I've got on 5, but I'm right now just stuck in the.
Have you given us 6 through 10?
Yeah, I've given you 6 through 10, I'm pretty sure. Everybody check.
I don't.
If it was with this original packet?
Yes.
Yeah, then 6 and through 10, 6 and through, you've got the 14, is in that.
Right, go forward. You've got the one here.
You've
got 14.
Formatting.
Oh, yeah, but are they all there?
Okay, I didn't realize.
Okay.
Okay.
If anybody doesn't have the packet, let me know and I will get you one.
I did not find mine, but again, the great work of our town planner got me.
Good job.
Okay, now if you want.
You're done.
Packet.
That was.
Five seconds. Who wants to take credit?
Marty's usually the one. All right, I'm gonna pick somebody.
I think he was the only silent one.
Well, second, I did.
All right, well, John, you got the second.
I think I was the first, second.
Okay.
Nine.
Oh, that's right.
Well, at least he's letting me not forget my coat. Last time we were here, I did.
Oh, did you?
I had to come back.
Going slow?
Yeah.